Hey there, Mr. Reddit here. Welcome back to another episode of r/EntitledParentStories. Today we have a very special episode for you, a compilation of some of the greatest Entitled Parent stories we read over the past year. So sit back, relax, and enjoy a few hours of the most entitled parents you've ever heard of. And by the way, Karen assured me that if this video gets 1,000 likes, she won't try to speak to anyone's manager for an entire week. So please smash that like button. And if you're new, subscribe and turn on notifications for new stories from Reddit every single day. And become an official member of the ReArmy today, and I'll give you a shout out in an upcoming video. r/EntitledParents. Entitled Mom wanted my shifts. Did not go well for her. After reading a related story somewhere else, my memory was jogged for this gem of a coworker a couple years back. I pull the early shift in a gas station slash car wash. My workday ends at 1 p.m. As the senior shift manager of several years, the boss had permanently assigned me to that shift, in part because of my rockstar punctuality. Waking up at 3 a.m. every day isn't for everyone, but it is for me. Entitled Mom had been with us for a few months, became a shift lead, and immediately began complaining about always having the night shift, 1 p.m. to 9 p.m., and how she never got to see her kids off the bus. And how because I'm not a parent, I should take whatever shift parents don't want. After weeks of nagging and claiming that her rights were being violated, I and the owner called her bluff. We tried a little experiment. For 1 week, I agreed to swap. Monday, she opens 20 minutes late. Boss gives her a verbal. Tuesday, on time, no problem. Wednesday, 5 minutes late, another gentle reminder. Thursday, 55 minutes late. She gets a written warning and the experiment is over. All our deliveries come in the early hours and had to be rescheduled. Friday, I open on time. Of course, this isn't the end of it. She complains that waking up that early shouldn't be possible for anyone, especially a parent, because raising kids is hard work. No argument there, but then she suggests that both of us do splits. Splits that would actually take hours away from me. She wants me to work from 5 to 8 a.m., have her from 8 to 2, then have me come back 2 to 5 and her 5 to 9. Boss dismissed that one right out of hand and told her that I have my set schedule because I have earned that set schedule by always being on time for it. She threatened, then actually did call the Department of Labor to lodge a discrimination complaint, which they quickly dismissed. She was hired for any available shift, which she accepted at hire. She ended up quitting, then blasting us hard on social media, saying parents deserve special treatment. We are anti-family. I am, but not vocal about it at work, etc. Boss told me she would humor no further experiments. The only way someone else is getting my coveted shifts is if I quit. Edit. Perhaps I spoke too harshly. I am very much a you-do-you person. I'm just against special societal privileges for people just by virtue of their choice to reproduce. Well, what do you think? Should Karen have gotten the shift she wanted or not? Please let us know. Maybe they should hire her to do security instead. Nobody wants to mess with a Karen. A Karen bridesmaid meets an unmovable force, my mother. A conversation with fellow crafters reminded me of this story, so I figured I'd share. Some quick background. My baby brother was born very ill, and the long hospital stays and expensive meds kicked in around 6 months old. To cope with the huge medical bills, Mom worked some odd jobs over the years, including making custom wedding and bridesmaids' gowns. My mother had a few very diehard rules. Number 1. She did all of your measurements. I heard the lecture of vanity fibbing only results in a poorly fitting dress, more times than I can count. Number 2. All final fittings must be completed at least 3 weeks before the wedding. That way, if Dewey had an emergency hospital stay, she'd have time to arrange for someone to sit with him while she went home to finish a job. He was nonverbal and needed a constant companion. This particular bride wanted all of her bridesmaids in pastel organza dresses. Organza is a gauzy fabric. The base dresses were white, covered with these colors. Unfortunately, the bride had more bridesmaids than pastel shades of fabric that came in, meaning one lucky bridesmaid wore tan. The bride refused to start a fight by assigning colors, so it was first come, first serve. When you came for measurements, you got to pick from the remaining colors. One bridesmaid lived 3 hours away and flat out refused to come to town to be measured. She insisted that telling us she was a size 8 was good enough. Bridal sizes are very different and didn't cleanly convert, so that meant nothing. Mom finally reached the compromise that a local seamstress could measure her and send in the measurements. 1 month before this wedding, Dewey was admitted into the ICU to be placed on a ventilator. Mom now had to find coverage enough to get 8 dresses finished off in the next 2 or so weeks. She pulled it off thanks to amazing friends, but it was tight. Dad was busy working overtime to pay the bills and dealing with us other 2 kids. Well, this jerk bridesmaid, BB from now on, still refused to have a final fitting more than 2 days before the wedding. She didn't want to waste a trip just because my mom was a horrible seamstress who didn't understand proper sizing. I was cleaning up seed pearls during that lovely conversation. My mom begged a friend to sit with Dewey for an entire day so she could do the fitting and adjustments all at once. Karen was 2 hours late. When she arrived, she saw the hideous tan dress and began literally screaming about how it wasn't fair and my mom must have picked that color. She demanded another bridesmaid return their dress and both dresses got swapped colors. It would have been 20 plus hours of work, so mom laughed and told her that was a big no. The bride arrived and told her friend that color was the only option left and she was sorry, but it was that or drop out of the wedding and pay for the dress anyways. Karen finally agreed to put it on. Yeah, she had lied about her size. When the zipper didn't go all the way up, mom whipped out the measuring tape only to discover this jerk had shaved 1 to 2 inches off every measurement except height. Her defense was that she wasn't going to let a jealous seamstress lie about her, so she fixed the numbers before passing them on. By this point, my mom was all but breathing fire. Her son's life hung in the balance, and this lunatic was making her life heck. My mom demanded double for the dress because she was going to have to add strips to the base white dress to make it big enough, then make a whole new overdress for Morganza. It was doubling the time and adding substantially to fabric costs. Karen fought over it, and my mom finally told her, "Fine, pay me the agreed-upon amount and take your dress as is." Now, the bride herself was bullying Karen into just paying up. She finally agreed to it, and my mom told the bride to get Karen out of her house. They could come back in 5 hours to get the dress. Thankfully, the redone dress was a perfect fit. Karen paid the remaining balance and left after that. The day my brother passed, my mom refused to ever make another wedding dress. She's only made one in the 21 years since as a favor to a friend who spent that ill-fated day with Dewey in the ICU while mom fought with Karen. Have you ever been to a wedding? And if so, what did you think of it? Please let us know.
The cake is the only thing I'm concerned with.
Am I the jerk for losing it when my husband used my brother's surgery money to buy his dad a car? I, female 25, have been married to my husband, male 27, for 2 years. My mom passed recently, and I let my brother, who's 16, move in with us. I'm taking care of everything for him, his education, his health, everything. He has a chronic respiratory disease, and he already has a savings account because my mom was saving up for his surgery in 2021. I moved the money into our account for several reasons, including issues from the bank itself. Ever since I began working, I started contributing as well. My husband knows well that that money isn't for us just because it's in our account. I repeatedly told him that he cannot make any purchases nor move that money without talking to me to make sure we don't touch the money that belongs to my brother. I just found out 2 days ago that my husband bought his dad a car that cost nearly $13,000. I was confused. I only heard this from his parents. We only had about $6,000 in our account aside from my brother's money. I got home and I asked him where he got the money. First, he said he'd talk about it in the morning because he was too tired to argue with me. My patience was running out. I asked him again and he told me he used some of my brother's money to pay for the car. I was stunned. He started making excuses about how his dad needed it and how much he was struggling and no one was willing to help. He said he didn't want to buy a cheap car so he won't have to suffer and take it to the shop every other day. I lost it and yelled at him and told him that this money was for my brother that my mom saved for his condition. He said he knew and didn't have a choice, said that he didn't want to tell me because of my reaction and that he borrowed some of the money and will find a way to pay it back soon. We got into a huge argument that lasted for 2 hours. I called his mom and told her about the car my father-in-law got, that he used my brother's money without even telling me. He lashed out at me after his mom found out and he got into an argument with his parents. He said that I shouldn't get them involved and I should have taken his word instead of freaking out and yelling at him. I couldn't take it. I took my brother and just went to stay with my aunt. He never stopped calling and apologizing, calling himself stupid and just wanting to help his dad. I haven't replied to his texts, and my aunt said that I shouldn't have yelled at him and instead sat down for a conversation. He keeps saying he'll pay the money back, but I know he can't. Well, who do you agree with? OP or her husband? Please let us know.
If you ever touch my money, I'll pop that head of yours like a balloon.
I need your long essay on a single page. Yes, ma'am. When I was a college sophomore, we had this professor, Mrs. Wang, in religion studies who would act like her subject should be our top priority. Although we came from different majors, religion studies is just a filler subject needed for students in this Catholic college. She wanted us to come to every meeting because attendance is a part of her grade, which was fine by me. But she would give us too many research assignments for so little time. This class is a Tuesday through Thursday one, so if she gives us 3 research assignments on Tuesday, the outputs are expected to be submitted on Thursday same week. This started a problem on all of us, since we also have a lot of things to do from major subjects. But it would be a hassle to fail a subject like this. Retaking a major subject is acceptable. Retaking a filler subject is annoying. One Tuesday, she gave us an assignment, a 4,000-word essay to be submitted on Thursday. 4,000 is a lot for us given the time frame, and that week was the week before midterms, so it gave us a hard time. But the catch, she wanted it on a single sheet of short bond paper, which is literally impossible to fit the 4,000-word essay. A classmate of mine, Nathan, asked Mrs. Wang about the single-page thing. Nathan asked if we could submit multiple pages of the essay to accommodate the 4,000-word essay she was asking us.
You are all stubborn. 4,000-word essay is a single page. That's simple.
Mrs. Wang was already in her early 60s at that time, so I don't think she had an idea of what a compressed 4,000-word in a single page would look like when printed. In every subject, we have a Facebook group for announcements, discussions between classmates, and note sharing. In some subjects, the teacher was usually the admin of the group, but since Mrs. Wang is not too fond of Facebook, one of our classmates volunteered to create a group for us. The night before the submission, we were having a problem with our outputs. Some classmates who were done with the essay tried to print their outputs. The font was too small, even though the margin was already adjusted. Here comes the malicious compliance. Nathan, who was still a little upset about the whole situation, posted a status on our group. Let's give her what she wants. 4,000 words in a single page. The comments were blowing up. Some commented that they were thinking of the same, and others were laughing. That time, the ha 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 reaction button wasn't still a thing, so literal ha 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 were filling up in the comments. The next day, we were all excited about our plan. One by one, we placed our papers on her table. As she was scanning on some papers, she went ballistic.
Why are these words so small?
Nathan raised his hand. Ma'am, you were clear about a 4,000-word essay on a single page. That's what it looks like. Mrs. Wang couldn't contain her anger. She realized she was wrong. Instead of apologizing, she just told us to reprint our outputs and submit them on Tuesday next week. We all agreed. Have you ever had a teacher demand something ridiculous from you? If so, what was it? Please let us know.
Watch yourself, teacher. I know where you park.
Complain about me logging into my phone 30 seconds late? I'll work my hours, but cost you money. My first job out of bar school was with an ambulance chasing firm. I worked 12 to 8 p.m. in the call center calling people after accidents to get them to sign with us for a personal injury claim. Officially, this was not cold calling as the details were passed to us by insurance companies who assured us that each lead had confirmed injuries and asked to speak to a lawyer. I have my doubts over how truthful the insurers were after a number of people I called denied any injury or seemed surprised to be contacted by a solicitor's firm, but that is not the cause of this story. I was very good at my job. Our target was for 10 new claims a day, so if you got a car with driver and passenger in the front and 3 kids in the back, you were laughing as that one call was half your quota. Many colleagues would go on to a go slow once they had their 10, but I kept busy. If nothing else, it was boring there when not working and time dragged, and would average about 25 new clients a day. After 6 months, we get a new manager in the call center. He's one of those micromanager types, which is a style I do not respond well to. I start getting emails saying things like,
"You were 30 seconds late logging into the system today. Make sure you stay late by that much time."
Now I should point out that up until now, I had logged out at the end of my shift, bang on time, unless I was on a call, in which case I would finish it. And if this was a call with 5 people in it, you could be stuck for another 45 minutes. We also had to turn the computers off at the end of the day. Easy, hit shut down and walk off, and then turn them on at the start of our shift. The computers being slow, this could take 5 minutes before you could log into your call system.
I responded to the first few emails, pointing out that logging into the call system 30 seconds late meant I had actually turned the computer on, which was technically part of my job, about 4.5 minutes before my shift started, and I stayed late regularly to finish calls. The manager told me that the time to turn on the computer was not part of my job, and I had to be ready to make calls bang on 12. I contacted HR, and they reluctantly agreed that turning on the computer was one of our duties, and therefore we only needed to be in ready to press the power button at 12. New manager was not easily been though. He started buying the time we got to our desks, and then, as is always the case when relying on public transport, if you were a few seconds or minutes late, he'd send the email telling you to work the extra time at the end of your shift. I decided that I had had enough of this, and so I decided to work to rule. I stopped trying to get new clients after hitting my 10 for the day and would play on the internet unless getting an incoming call from someone responding to a voicemail. I wouldn't make any outgoing calls after hitting the daily target. I also decided that if I was on a call after 8 p.m, I would simply tell the potential client, "My shift has now finished," hang up, and turn the computer off. I did this for a week and encouraged others to do it. When the weekly stats hit my boss's desk, he realized we were about a third down in terms of clients secured compared to other weeks. He called us into a meeting with his head of department and lost it on us, asking why we were all lazy and not securing clients, screaming about us hanging up on clients. I just said, "You told us you wanted us to work as required by the contract, down to the second. That's all we're doing. Do you not like it?" A few weeks later, he was gone, and a much more sensible manager moved in. Things went back to the way they were. I ended up staying at the firm for 7 years, although only in the call center for 9 months before moving on to case handling and then trial work. The form says you must inspect all donations. I will give all people and entities names that correspond with their function within this story. Years ago, I started a new job. I'm a biology professor, and this job was at a small, private college. Note, as this is important, and people sometimes confuse these terms, private is not the same as for profit. Private just means that we aren't operated by the state. Like most colleges, we are nonprofit. This college is also located within easy driving distance of a branch of a large state university. One of the first things I do is get us some free stuff. We have a lot of out-of-date equipment, analog when everyone has moved to digital, and a lot less glassware, beakers, etc. than we need. Some of my grad school buddies work at large state university nearby, so I call them up and ask if anyone is clearing out their lab. See, at a lot of these universities, when faculty leave or retire, anything left in their lab that isn't cutting edge and super expensive goes into state surplus. There are only two legal ways that I know of to avoid sending them to surplus: move it to someone else in the department or donate it to a nonprofit. It turns out that I actually know the person who all of this equipment goes to after being picked over in-house to be surplused, and so she lets me come by her storage space and pick through it next. Great story, right? I solve a problem for us, and large state university saves time and looks generous. Of course, that's not the end of this, or it wouldn't belong here. It turns out that I'm unaware of two things. First, by doing this, I have just made someone senior to me, but not in my command chain, look incompetent. This isn't hard, since that's the truth. Second, one of the reasons we seem not to have replaced things in a while is that there were, several years before I came, some major financial shenanigans, the sort where senior people resign, effective immediately, and the locks on their office doors get changed overnight. Because of the second point, paperwork has been created to document all sorts of transactions around the college. I don't know that this is helpful paperwork, since the sorts of transactions I'm about to describe weren't part of the financial shenanigans. But as we know from thermodynamics, once useful work is converted into paperwork, it can never be converted back into useful work again. Needless to say, senior professor complains to my department chair that I haven't filled out the donation paperwork, and so I'm violating our financial transparency obligations. I'm basically just Satan, etc. It probably doesn't help that senior professor also has the sort of attitude towards paperwork that leads me to suspect that instead of pets, she just has stacks of compliance forms lying around her house. My department chair, the person who could actually fire me, gives me the forms and asks that I fill them out appropriately. One item on this form is an estimate of the financial size of the gift. Obviously, if you're donating a few thousand dollars to the university, which is probably what the form is actually for, you just write down the amount. For physical items, you need to estimate their value. I have a box of random equipment. I know more are coming, and I don't want to waste time looking up every piece of equipment. Writing the price down calculating some sort of reasonable discount because it's used items, and putting the full, itemized list in the space available, which is about this large. Still, not the real malicious compliance here, but I duck this one. I didn't donate anything, I say. My chair is confused. But you came in with this box of glassware and told everyone in the department to come get what they needed from it. Me. Right, but that's a donation from large state university to our college, not to me. I just drove it here out of the goodness of my heart. If they donated it to me personally, that would be illegal, since they're required to donate it to a nonprofit. My chair, who came from industry and has a bit more business sense than some pure researchers, understands that this is correct. However, I can see that there is a problem coming. The next set of things I want to get are some decent animal skulls. We have about 3 species on hand, one of them human. Everywhere else I've taught, we generally have at least a dozen species on hand, and it's very useful when you are teaching anything that involves comparative anatomy. But my plan has been to use my own skills to clean the skulls of road-killed animals. That will be a donation from me, every time, and I don't want to do this paperwork. It's now Christmas, and I'm visiting with some of my wife's friends back home. They are reminded that I'm a biologist and walk me out into the woods where they show me a deer skull. It's been there for years. We never had a use for it. It's yours if you want it. It's a doe. No antlers, which is what most people want. But for scientific purposes, that's fine. And we don't have one at work. I take it. Several weeks later, all of the relevant parties are back on campus. I wrap up the skull in a plastic grocery bag and take it in to donate. A note about old skulls, in case for some reason you don't have a career where you need to age skeletal elements by looking at them. Mammal skulls are made from many separate bones that fuse together at the edges. As a skull ages outside in the elements, many of these sutures open. This means that a skull that has been sitting outside for long enough is extremely dirty. The dirt is just dirt, since maggots and other flesh-eating insects pick every scrap of flesh away. But an item full of crevices sitting on dirt, with leaves falling on it, picks up a lot of debris. If you don't know anything about old skulls, you, rather naturally, assume that this debris is rotting flesh. The bag is there to contain this dirt. I need the donation form, I tell our administrative assistant. She gives me the form. I walk back to my office, and I carefully fill it out. Where it says value of donation, I fill in $0. This is important. I technically don't need to fill out this paperwork if the item is worthless, but I need to fill out the paperwork because I need to present the paperwork and the item to our financial department so that they can verify the item is worthless and that I didn't need to do the paperwork. A brilliant, well-designed system, as you can see. I ask our administrative assistant where the financial office is, since I'm still new enough that I don't really know. She tells me where, but says she has to go to that building anyway, and she'd be happy to take the paperwork and item with her. I say thanks, but no thanks. I'm taking it over now. I walk into the financial office. Everyone has a fancy nameplate, a desk with neatly marked trays for incoming and outgoing forms, and everyone seems to be dressed like someone had said, "Dress like you handle money all day, but actually buy everything from Walmart." Thankfully, the nameplates include job titles, so I walk over to the person who needs to validate my claims. "What's this about?" she asks. "I have this donation for the biology department, and I've been told I need to fill out this paperwork, and that you need to see the item." "That's correct," she says, taking the paperwork from me. She starts to read, frowning like she might be able to accuse me of fraud. It's quite possible that, contrary to her parents' instructions, she made that face for so long that it has frozen this way. "And this is the item," I say, reaching into a ratty plastic bag and pulling out the skull. The nose pointed towards her is a gaping hole with thin bones called turbinates winding back into the recesses of the skull. There's also a leaf, wedged into the nose somehow out in the woods. A chunk of dirt drops from the inside of the brain case and falls to the floor. "What is that?" she says, clearly thrown off her routine. I have learned that most people find that most mammal skulls look the same, even though to me they look very different. "A deer skull," I say. "It was found in the woods by friends of mine. Here, take a look." I helpfully extend the skull towards her. A trickle of debris loosens itself from the back of the eye socket and rattles off the papers on her desk. I can see her cringe. "I've assessed its value at $0, but I was told that you needed to personally inspect items to make sure of this." I turn the skull over in my hands as I say this, still holding it out in presentation mode, as if I thought that she couldn't properly assess its value without examining the strange brown stain on the bone that once formed the roof of the mouth. "I agree with that assessment," she says quite rapidly.
At this point, I relent slightly and pull the skull back towards my chest so it is no longer extended over her desk. I casually fish a partial leaf from a suture in the top surface of the skull and drop it in the plastic bag I brought. "I have a few more of these coming," I mention. "I'll be cleaning those myself, so they'll be in better shape. Possibly more organic material left on them, though. Will you be needing to see those as well?" "No," she says, quite definitively. "So, just to get this straight, you, as a representative of our financial office, are telling me that all donations of such biological specimens are worth $0 and that you do not want to see them or the accompanying paperwork?" "Yes," she says. I stick the skull back into its traveling bag and, as a gesture of goodwill, sweep some debris off her desk and into the bag as well. It's a deal. Karen threatens to sue a bakery over a cake. Today was my aunt's birthday, so it reminded me of something funny that happened 2 years ago. First, a little bit of context. My aunt really likes cakes, but her favorite ones are from a bakery chain that only has 2 stores in our city, both of which open at 10 a.m. from Monday to Saturday and at 11 a.m. on Sundays. This story took place on a Sunday. Now, the place normally sells cakes of 1 or 2 kilograms each, but if you want a cake of 3 kilograms or more, you have to make your order within 1 day of anticipation and can pick it up as soon as the bakery opens. Now, as my aunt's party was mostly going to be a small reunion with just our closest family present, my mom decided to just buy a 2 kilogram cake since it's easier, especially because the bakery isn't exactly near our house and you can't just call to have your cake made. You have to go to the store and leave 50% of the money. So that day we arrived a few minutes before the opening hour and stood there waiting for the employees to open up the doors. The place had some pretty large windows too, meaning you could look inside and see the employees cleaning the place, bringing the cakes from the back and into the fridges and such. It was then that the devil herself arrived. A typical Karen with blonde hair, expensive looking clothing, lots of makeup, 2 mini monsters, aka kids, and that "I'm better than everyone else" attitude. She tried pushing the doors open despite the sign that read "closed," and me and my mom standing there quite obviously waiting for the place to open. More so, it wasn't even 11 a.m. yet. But still, she huffed and shook her head in exasperation as if the door had somehow wronged her. "Ugh, I can't believe they haven't opened yet," she complained loudly, looking at us as if we were going to agree with her. We just stared at her like she was crazy. "It is very disrespectful to keep us here waiting. I can't believe this lack of professionalism." My mom just nodded her head, and we both proceeded to ignore her until the clock struck 11, at which point she started pretty much banging on the door and demanding loudly that someone open the store, saying she would sue them and have their jobs and whatever. I had to turn around so she couldn't see me trying to contain my laughter. It was such a funny sight, seeing a full-grown adult throwing up a tantrum just because a bakery hadn't opened exactly at 11 a.m. I actually suspect that this made the employees not want to open, since it took them about 5 more minutes to let us inside. And of course, the Karen went full, "I want to speak to your manager," as soon as she stepped inside. Meanwhile, my mom and I went to look at the cakes, trying to decide which one we'd buy, but we couldn't help overhearing her. "This is such a huge disrespect," she was screeching to the poor manager. "Do you even know who I am? I work for a law firm, and I can't be wasting time here waiting for your lazy staff to open. I'll sue you." I really don't know what she was trying to accomplish with this huge tantrum, because as soon as the manager offered to give her a discount, she was like, "No, forget it. I won't be buying anything from you ever again." And with that, she grabbed her kids and stormed out of the store, but not without stopping at the door and looking to my mom, saying, "You can have this stupid cake." Turns out, her cake was not only a 3-kilogram cake, but it was made of blackberries instead of strawberries, like the normal cakes, which made it more expensive. But coincidentally, it was also my aunt's favorite. And not only that, Karen had already paid for half of it. My mom and I just looked at each other, smirked, and brought the cake to the counter. And the employee was very happy to sell it to us. Guess some good things can come out from encountering a Karen in the wild. Am I the jerk for choosing my son's now ex-girlfriend over him? Everything is a gigantic mess right now, and I don't know if I'm doing the right thing. I have a son named Will, who's 22. His mother and I split when he was 4, and we shared custody. For over a year, Will has been going out with his girlfriend, Elise, who's 19, and they moved in together 5 months ago. She's a very sweet and respectful girl, and I thought they made a nice couple. Well, almost 2 months ago, I heard from my ex-wife that Will kicked Elise out after he found out she was pregnant. I didn't want to believe that was the only reason and called Will. He explained to me that Elise told him she was pregnant and he was furious with her because she wanted to keep it. He said he wants nothing to do with her or the baby and he's not going to pay a cent. I was appalled by his attitude about all of this and reminded him that it takes two to make a baby and he needs to own up to his actions. Will said it was all Elise's fault for not wanting to get rid of the baby. He was far too upset and I felt myself getting angry too. I told him I'd call again when he's calmed down. I reached out to Elise and she was a mess. The poor girl was terrified. She said she didn't expect Will to react this way. I found out she was forced to stay at a friend's house because her parents are also refusing to let her move back because she shamed them. I talked with my wife and we agreed to have Elise come live with us in our spare bedroom. I've spoken to Will many times and he's still adamant about not being involved or at the very least helping out financially because he doesn't want to be a dad or to ruin his life. Our last talk, I got so furious with him, I said if he doesn't want to accept any responsibility for his child, then I will do the same and have nothing to do with him. My ex-wife called me because Will complained I was siding with Elise over him and said I don't have to cut contact with him over this. We had our own fight, but I refused to budge. It's been a few weeks like this now without any contact. Will has tried calling me several times and left many angry voicemails and texts saying I betrayed him. I had to block him. It just breaks my heart, and I'm wondering where exactly we went wrong as parents. Where I went wrong. I really thought we raised him better than this and taught him that in life, it's always important to take responsibility for your actions, and now he's completely running away from them. My ex is very angry with me for turning my back on him, even if she doesn't agree with what he's doing either. My wife and I decided we would help Elise with the baby and all other expenses, and that she's free to stay with us as long as she needs to. But this whole thing with Will, I don't know if it was a bad move as a father or not, or if I'm being a jerk. I guess that's what I'm here to ask. Karen demands her caviar and goes on to completely lose it at my store. This is a story from 2015, back when I was a meat manager. I was recently reminded of this incident while explaining a similar topic to a fellow customer. As any person in a retail position knows, the crazies come out near the holidays. Those customers that can't be reasoned with no matter how much proof you show them. This is one of those stories. A bit of info. In my own time, I'll cut up wild game, deer, elk, fish, in exchange for a share of meat. So I have a few game wardens on speed dial to make sure that everything is legal, pertinent to the story. Around Christmas of 2015, I was preparing prime roast orders for the holidays, as I basically had the past few days, when my meat clerk said a customer was looking for a form of caviar that he hadn't heard of before. I went out to see what help I could offer. We've got entitled Mom. Tall, blonde, 40-ish, Karen cut shoulder-length hair, two kids. Rude from the start. Oh, good. Perhaps you can help me. This employee has no idea what he's doing. Me. Yes, miss. What kind of caviar are you looking for? Entitled Mom. I'm looking for beluga, sturgeon caviar from the Caspian Sea. I bought it here a few years ago, and it was amazing. I haven't been able to find it anywhere. Me. Ma'am, I'm sorry. You must be mistaken. We have never carried beluga caviar. Last I heard, beluga caviar has been banned in the USA since 2005. There was a hybrid farm certified in Florida in 2016. Entitled Kid 1, full volume. Mom, look at the fish. Now sticking his fingers against the glass case. Entitled Mom. Shh, can't you see I'm talking? Back to her full volume. That's impossible. I picked it up here a few years back for $100. You can't BS me. Me. Ma'am, please keep your voice down and refrain from using harsh language. This is a family-friendly store. Ma'am, when beluga caviar was last sold in 2005, it was $400 to $600 an ounce. Once again, we have never sold beluga caviar. Perhaps it was a different sturgeon caviar. We have some that are at the $100 price range. Karen, I don't believe this BS. I know what I bought. My husband is on the city council, and I'm going to tell him about this and get you shut down. Me. At this point, I walked away to call security. She had left when I had gotten back. I didn't think much of it afterwards, just another crazy customer. A few weeks later, the same Karen came back, but this time to gloat. Karen. I came to show you that we were able to get it. The price was ridiculous, but we have photos showing it is the real deal. She had photos of not only the fish that was caught for the eggs, but video of three men catching it, the weight, cost, shipping ticket, proof, and pictures of them eating it. She was also here to place an order for a roast. I asked the clerk to get the order. Ask for an address under the premises of it being over a $200 order. I went to the back and called the game warden, Fish and Wildlife. I reported to the store manager what I had been shown and had the approval to report it. Game warden came in asking for the entitled mom's info and it was freely given. I heard from the same game warden a few months later when calling about a few Chinook salmon a man had brought in. Entitled mom was given a search warrant and was found to have illegal beluga caviar in their freezer, after lab tests, I'd guess. I was told that they were given a fine of $1,200 for the caviar, but still had a pending trial that could charge them up to $25,000 and jail time for their actions that led to the death of an endangered species, international shipping of illegal goods, and a few others I don't quite remember. I offered to be a witness, but as they had the pictures, product, and messages between the sellers and entitled mom and entitled dad, they had plenty of evidence for a conviction. I wasn't given any info on the results of the trial afterwards. If I could remember her name, I'd try looking it up since it's likely public record. Edit. I forgot to mention, Entitled Dad did work in the city council, but not as a seat or such. He is, or was, a manager in the public works area, wastewater. I can't imagine that he was able to keep that job as the government slash city higher-ups don't generally have a large criminal background. Edit 2. I'm glad everyone learned about the beluga sturgeon. I honestly feel bad for the kids that have parents such as these. I always wonder how the kids are doing after one of the parents ends up in law trouble. Have you ever tried caviar? If not, would you like to? Please let us know. I'd prefer some McDonald's, but hey, to each their own. Boss likes to see me beg? Enjoy seeing your money every day, but not being able to use it. So a bit of background first. I joined a bank, and after a few months, we had a management change in the division. The new division head brought some of the guys from his previous bank. Usually that's how it works in banks in my country. But the thing was that he treated the old team members like crap, and his boys were spending time surfing the net and presenting others' work to the management as their own. The issues. 1. I had an incredible workload, which made me to work 3 to 3.5 hours overtime daily without overtime pay. 2. My first year with the new boss, I got zero increment, while his boys who joined in the last 6 months all got promotions. 3. The boss was petty and had a god complex. His boys would do apple polishing all day. 4. Gave no days off when I had the flu. 5. He and his boys would make sure everyone laughed and made fun of any tiny mistakes that happened in my work. As I had a huge workload, I did make a few small mistakes, but nothing that caused any loss. 6. They knew I got married and had a baby on the way, so I couldn't resign. So they went as far as making fun of my personal issues right in front of me. 7. They were simply a gang of jerks. So this goes on for like a good 1.5 years, until I get a substantial offer from a better bank. It was a unique department, and we have less than 10 banks in my country, so other opportunities were hard to come by. So one fine 1st of January, I got the offer letter for the new job and decided to resign. That same day, my yearly performance review was done. As expected, it was a crappy one, since I was doing nothing important. So I decided to resign in protest of the bad performance review. Now, it's important to know the law in my country to switch banks. In order to join another bank from a new bank, you need to have a release letter from your previous bank. And in order to get your pay from your new bank, you need an NOC, no objection certificate, from your previous bank. Normally, the banks give an NOC a month after your last working day. It's done to see if you have any things hiding in your desk that might be fraud of stealing money. Yes, that happens a lot. That way, you can be forced to come back to your previous employer to settle the irregularities. Also, legally, you have to give a 3 month notice period. But in practice, a month is given and the next 2 months are waived, depending on how senior your position is. Mine was not. So here's the boss' final move. He says I have to do the whole 3 months because the work I was doing was very technical and needed longer to be learned by the guys in the team. But my last 2 yearly performance reviews said I was not doing anything important. Also, I had a staff loan that had an outstanding amount of just 20% of my basic salary. So my manager told me because of the policy, which I missed in fine print in the HR manual, I would not be paid monthly salary, but at the end of my 3 month notice, I would be paid all my outstanding dues minus the loan amount, which was just peanuts. Now my pro revenge ensues. Firstly, I had told my new employer that I would be joining after 3 months, and they agreed, so I was good on that. I had savings, so I could just wait out the 3 months, but it would be very difficult for me to manage. Suddenly, the boss and his boys started joking about me not getting pay and being a beggar. They would put their change coins on my workstation and tell me it's charity. So, they want to see me beg? They shall see me beg. I went to my boss, told him a story, and asked him for some cash, faked some tears as well. Did the same thing to each of his boys. Since they all had God complexes, seeing me beg for money stroked their egos, and they gave me cash to help me out since I was broke and had no money for my son's milk and diapers. It was done with a condition not to tell anyone, please. It took them 2 weeks to tell each other that I was begging for money from each of them, and they all gave it to me. Collectively, I had borrowed 2 months of my salary from the boss and his boys. By this time, I had already done 1 month of notice period. So since it was just cash given by one person to another in a closed cabin room or outside the bank, there was no paper proof that I had borrowed money. Given the crappy law and order situation in my country, they couldn't recover the money from me anyway else. The boss smelled the revenge brewing, as he understood what I was doing. All of a sudden, he and his boys were nice to me. The joke stopped, and they finally assigned 3 guys to take over my work. But my revenge had already started. I would come to the office around 11 a.m. and leave around 3 p.m. instead of the usual 9 a.m. to 6 p.m. hours. Suddenly, I had an amnesia attack and wasn't much help for the guys taking over my work. So they had to go through trial and error, which impacted operations and got them slack from management. My boss, realizing that since I owed them money which they can't recover if I'm upset or fired, decided to let me leave the bank immediately. So the HR was told to release me on urgent basis. In their hurry, they made a fatal mistake. The next day, HR manager called me in, handed over my letter of release and NOC at the same time, along with all the money I was owed, Provident Fund, etc. In short, I was free to join the new bank and even get paid. So the previous bank cannot claim anything to me now. Plus, I had more than enough money in my account. So after the usual best of luck and all the best on my final day at work, the manager said, "You owe X amount of money to me and the boys. It would be nice if you could transfer that amount to his account and he will distribute it with the boys." My reply was, "What money?" I proceeded to join the new bank and lived happily ever after. I got a lot of calls and threats from the boss and his boys, but forget them. As extra rubbing, I kept the amount I owed them in my account in the same bank. So every morning they would come to work, pull up my account balance, see their money sitting there, give a few bad words to me, and carry on with their work. It's been 6 years now. The money is still there, and I made sure the account is still active. Have you ever had a boss treat you unfairly? If so, what were they doing? Please let us know.
"You treat me unfairly, Mr. Reddit. You never let me read the stories, even though our listeners would love it."
Am I the jerk for telling an employee that pregnancy is not an excuse for low productivity? I work in an office. Due to the nature of our work and our employer, we are not working remotely right now, where I supervise a team of 3 people. The end of the year is our crunch time, and it means that my entire team is putting in more hours than normal, and everyone is expected to answer their phones and emails pretty much around the clock. Christmas except, of course. Most of my team is doing great, except for one woman I'll call Kara. Kara told me 2 weeks ago that she is pregnant and she is about 10 weeks along. The only reason she told me in the first place was because I had to write her up for not being as available as she needed to be. She was calling in sick at least once a week for the past 4 weeks, and when she was at the office, she was not 100% focused on her work. She explained that she has severe morning sickness and that she's been vomiting multiple times per day, and some days she needed to take off. I agreed to work with her and told her that she can come in later and stay later if she needs to get around the morning sickness, but she apparently is sick all day. I made other concessions too. I am allowing time off for doctor's appointments and allowing her to take more frequent breaks throughout the day. Apparently, she can no longer eat a regular lunch and must eat multiple times during the day. This all seemed perfectly reasonable to me as long as she held up her part of the bargain and maintained her productivity during this stressful time. Well, she has not. She has called out sick once already since then, and she has not made herself available for calls during off hours. My other staff is staying at the office until 8 or 9 in the evening, but Kara is out by 6 and apparently goes straight to sleep when she gets home and keeps her phone muted during that time. We have had to scramble to cover for her. Her work quality has also suffered, as apparently she has difficulty concentrating due to headaches and won't take anything for them. I sat her down yesterday and relayed my concerns. She acknowledged how her lack of productivity has hurt the rest of the staff, but claimed that she is physically struggling a great deal. I told her that was no excuse, because she is only in her first trimester and barely even pregnant yet. I also questioned whether it was fair to other women that she was using a normal bodily function as an excuse for low productivity. She said she understood and would try to do better. I told my wife about it, and she called me a jerk, saying that I have no idea how hard pregnancy can be. I just think it is unfair for an entire staff to pick up someone's slack because they made a personal decision to become pregnant. So, am I the jerk? Well, what do you think? Is OP the jerk or not? Please let us know. You want the house? Okay, good luck with the renovations. This happened in year 2015. My grandmother on my father's side passed in 2007, bless her soul. She owned a house and a lot, a bungalow type near the sea. This house wasn't paid in full, and there's still a remaining balance of $5,200. This is already big money for us. Because my father is the only son, his older sisters agreed he should get the house. There was no will, but he should pay the remaining balance. We lived there and renovated the house. My father did almost 75% of the work. He added two bathrooms, a ceiling, furniture, another bathroom, tiled the floors, kitchen sink, and septic tank. No drainage system on that location. Basically, we received the house in bare shape. We paid it off in 2015, but we didn't receive the title. There were so many excuses. 2016 comes. His nephew, a retired commander, visited my parents and told my father that he wants to add a second floor so he and his wife could live there also. My father didn't agree, and he called his older sister to see if they would want that to happen. They just said that they didn't want to get involved. His nephew showed him that he already had the title of the house. Don't know how he got it. Maybe he used his political background. I'm not sure. My father was furious. He called me and told me what happened. By that time, I had already bought a small patch of land for them when they want to retire, but I'm still saving enough money to build a house suitable for their needs. There were court battles that I will not include, but in the end, his nephew won. But there was an agreement that he has to pay my father $7,400. He mailed us the contract that we need to vacate the house after 6 months, and there were specific demands that our lawyer pointed out. A. We should repaint the house, no specific color. B. Leave the house in original state. Guess what? We hired a construction team to demolish the bedroom, the bathroom, remove the ceiling, kitchen sink, tiled floor, and also the septic tank, leaving it in its original state. We spent about $2,800, including the labor. The cherry on top, we painted the house with black inside and red outside with violet dots. It was a huge eyesore. I was bombarded with lots of calls and messages from my aunts and cousin, which I didn't reply to. We went no contact after that. My parents now live in a beautiful farmhouse tending their small garden. They enjoy morning walks by the lake, just living in a stress-free environment. They are planning to adopt a puppy next month. Edit: we got our money back because we have receipts proving we paid the remaining balance. Am I the jerk for ruining Christmas by kicking out my daughter-in-law for humiliating me? I have three kids, two boys and one girl. I get along really well with two of their spouses. Patrick is a little different. He has always been asocial and introverted and could be mean to his sister, making fun of her and putting her and her interests down. Patrick met daughter-in-law 15 years ago. They got married 8 years ago. Daughter-in-law is the one I struggle with. I've tried to be as inviting and warm and loving to her as all the other spouses. She's also mean to my daughter. She makes fun of her and even refers to daughter as a beard because daughter's spouse is effeminate. Sorry if this is confusing. This year, when baking cookies with my daughter and daughter-in-law told me to not get Patrick any gifts because he doesn't want any. He hates getting gifts. I've always known Patrick wasn't much for gifts, so we'd go very simple and practical, thinking of things we could upgrade for him. Pots and pans, power tools, etc. But daughter-in-law was very insistent about it this year. He was always appreciative and admitted he could use them, but she insisted, so I didn't get Patrick anything. When we opened presents this year, everyone was laughing and having fun. When we got to the end, and daughter-in-law turns and looks at me and says, "Where's Patrick's present?" I said, "You told me not to get him anything, remember?" She said, "No, I didn't." My daughter says, yeah, you did. I was there." Daughter-in-law then laughs and says, "You guys must be off your meds again." Daughter and I both manage mental health issues, so this was an example of daughter-in-law's mean streak. I was so humiliated and upset by her little comment that I just snapped. I told daughter-in-law and Patrick to leave and to not bother coming by again until daughter-in-law can learn how to be a good daughter-in-law, and told Patrick that the way he allows her to trash the members of our family is just unacceptable. Daughter is on my side, but Christmas was awkward after that, and my husband and other son told me that I overreacted and that it's just her sense of humor, and that I should be used to it by now. Used to what? Being disrespected and mocked in my own home? But I don't know if my actions were too over the top or not. I know I ruined Christmas for them, but what about me? What about my Christmas? Well, who do you think is the jerk? OP or her daughter-in-law? Please let us know.
I wouldn't allow that little jerk back into my home.
You only get paid for 37 hours work. Okay, I'll only stay for that long. So I worked as an executive pastry chef for a medium-sized hotel here in England where we catered mainly to weddings on weekends but had a successful restaurant that ran alongside it doing two-thirds rosette quality food, about 60 covers a night. Well, as anybody who has worked in catering may know, it's not uncommon to work a tremendous amount of hours in a week on a consistent basis. Here I was working about 75 to 80-ish hours a week, 5 days of about 14 to 15 hours, then an extra 5 or 6 or so on my day off. Now it's important to know that we did not get paid for overtime here as chefs. You worked all of these hours and you got paid for 37.5 hours. That's 40 hours in work where they took 30 minutes off for 5 days for a lunch break that you never even had. You do all this and life sucks doing it. But it's a job and it's not easy in catering at the best of times. So the straw that broke the camel's back comes when I get pulled by the finance manager because I left on one of those days after 5 hours. You see, they ran their weeks Thursday through Wednesday for pay and rota, etc. I left on a Thursday to go look after a family member on my day off that I'd already gone into work to help out on. But because it was a Thursday and the start of the week, I hadn't done enough hours in that week to justify leaving early. My explaining was that it was, one, my day off, really. Two, I had worked 45 hours between Monday through Wednesday. And three, I didn't get paid for any extra work. Didn't seem to help. They got annoyed and said, "You get paid for 37.5 hours. No more. If you can't do your work in that time, then that's your problem. But you get paid no extra." Well, that played right into my hands. See, I mentioned above they had weddings at weekends. Well, that played right into my hands. See, I mentioned above that they had weddings on weekends and a busy restaurant that we used to have to service at the same time. If that sounds stupid and almost impossible, that's because it was. Well, the Saturday the following week was a big weekend for them. Bank holiday, big wedding, full restaurant, etc. So me and two of the other chefs decided we would work the 37.5 paid hours, then leave. So we worked Thursday and Friday, racking up 31 paid hours there. Then Saturday, we all had the full day shift, breakfast through till close. So we started at 6 a.m. and then 2 p.m. rolls around. Well, that's our 8 paid hours. So we left. We just simply downed tools, got changed and walked out. Left the kitchen as it was. Left the food prep where it was. Didn't finish prepping for the night. We did nothing. 5 minutes later, I get a very angry call from the general manager who wanted me back there immediately to work the shift and finish the wedding, etc. Or they couldn't do it without me. I politely explained that I was told to only work my 37.5 hours or it wasn't my issue. So that's what I did. The night was a disaster by all accounts and it cost the company thousands in compensation to the wedding party and in lost revenue for the restaurant. Never mind the reputational damage. Didn't go back into work until the following Thursday when my weekly hours started again. I got to keep my job. Not easy to replace a pastry chef of my skill who ran the kitchen for them most of the time. One of the others got sacked as he was easily replaced and the other got his hours cut until he quit. Catering is not a nice place to work. They're real jerks. Ultimately, I left about 6 months later. I got fed up of working for free as it had just gone back to normal. Left being owed about 20,000 pounds of overtime that I never got. Company went bankrupt dodgily and destroyed all evidence of hours worked, employment records, etc. So we got done over. The same guy rebought the hotel under a new name, etc. So it's all very shady. Am I the jerk for refusing to drive my brother around anymore, therefore making my parents' lives way harder? I, 20, female, am living with my parents and my younger brother, who's 17. My parents and I generally get along well, but my brother is an absolutely awful person. He's always been very stubborn when we were younger, but in the last couple of years, his behavior has gotten way worse and extreme. Unfortunately, my parents are enabling him. My brother is part of the self-proclaimed popular kids at school, and he constantly looks down on anyone he doesn't think is cool enough for him. He often uses all kinds of names he shouldn't be calling people and makes offensive jokes around me and my mom. He and his friend group have often hung out during lockdown to drink together, and they even got caught by the police once. They got off with a warning. At home, his behavior continues. He always leaves messes for others to clean up. He listens to loud music and FaceTimes his friends while talking super loud until 4 a.m. nearly every night. Unfortunately, my parents never discipline him because whenever my parents even hint that his behavior is wrong, he freaks out. If my parents say he can't, for example, hang out with his friends because of the lockdown, he throws a huge temper tantrum and insults everybody until he gets his way. Since my brother isn't allowed to drive by himself yet, me and my parents have to drive him places all the time. A couple of days ago, he asked me if I could drive him to a supermarket because he needed to buy something. I was in a good mood, so I decided to drive him, and while my brother was in the supermarket, I stayed in the car and read a book. When my brother returned to the car and sat down next to me in the passenger seat, I asked him to hold my book while I'm driving. He said that he didn't feel like holding anything and carelessly threw my book in the back seat. I told him to get it back because when I have to brake, it'll fall down, and I wasn't able to get it because, well, I was driving. He refused, so at the next traffic light, I brake, the book falls down, and it now has a huge dent. I was seriously mad at my brother, and he just laughed condescendingly and told me I'm overreacting. At this point, all his crappy behavior over the years really hit me for some reason, and I decided for myself that enough is enough. I told my parents that from now on, I won't do my brother any favors anymore, and that includes driving him anywhere until he changes. My parents both work, so sometimes they rely on me to drive my brother somewhere, but I won't do that anymore. If he wants me to pick him up from school, he can take the bus. If he wants to meet his friends, he can walk or go by bike. My parents now say that I'm making their lives way harder, so now I'm conflicted. Am I the jerk for refusing to drive my brother around anymore? Well, what do you think? Is OP the jerk or is their brother? Please let us know.
Definitely the brother and the parents for letting him act like that. Entitled kids don't make themselves, you know.
Entitled shopper demands I pay for her stuff. This happened just an hour ago, and I'm laughing at the insanity and absurdity at the situation. So, as everyone is painfully aware, there's a little situation going on in the world, and we're on lockdown with the exception of going out for essential shopping. So, some backstory. My Nan and I are close. She's the fifth member of our family. My dad, me, my brother, and my Nan. And she's elderly, disabled, and asthmatic, so she's high risk and vulnerable. Now, I'm also severely asthmatic, and I probably shouldn't be going out shopping, but for my Nan, I'm willing to risk it. So I go out to do her shopping at Morrison's. She gives me her shopping list, and I get what she needs / what's available. So this entitled shopper started off by ramming me with her trolley while I was waiting to scan my items and pay, and was invading my personal space. Very rude. So I begin placing my items on the till, and she's just glaring at me for some reason and muttering to herself about me hurrying up. I place the divider and go to start bagging my items. "I'm sorry, I didn't realize I had to rush for you." So as I'm bagging my items and about to pay, the cashier continues scanning strange items that I know I wasn't buying. I ask the cashier, "But what's going on? Those aren't mine." And the cashier is confused, saying there's no divider. I look up, and this entitled jerk has removed the divider, and now her items were being scanned and added to my bill. I tell the cashier, and she starts to remove the items and sort the mistake. This is when entitled shopper goes insane.
"Excuse me? What are you doing?"
I'm confused and tell her that her items were accidentally being scanned and thinking that the divider must have been buried in the shopping and didn't think it was a big deal as the cashier was apologetic and sorted it.
"You need to pay for my shopping."
I'm just shocked and simply say, "What?" She glares at me.
"My items were being scanned on your shopping, so you have to pay for them. And since you're paying for some now, you must buy my whole shopping."
I give the cashier a look and am absolutely gobsmacked. "What makes you think I'm going to buy your shopping?" She scoffs and continues on about how a few mistakes mean I have to pay. I pay for my items and she still stood there expectantly waiting for me to pay for her shopping. I begin to walk away and she screams for me to come back. People are now staring, so I turn and say, "Lady, I don't know you, and I don't have to buy your shopping for any reason." She then screams for security and feeds them some lie about me having to pay for her stuff. He called me over to ask what was happening, and I told him. She then went on, admitting she removed the divider, thinking I wouldn't notice and I'd pay for her. Thankfully, the security guard just looked at her and told her the same thing I said, that I didn't have to. As I began walking away, she was screaming at the cashier, saying she didn't have any cash or cards on her to pay, and was demanding her to honor some expired coupons. I left before anything else, so I don't know how it ended. So this lady thought she was entitled to her shopping and I had to pay for it, as she didn't have any way to pay for it. Honestly, how can you be so stupid to not bring a means of paying for groceries? I'm wondering if she had tried it before and whether it worked on other people. I ain't buying someone else's shopping for no good reason. Entitled parent breaks glass all over the floor at my work and blames it on me. Backstory. When I was 17, I got a part-time job for the summer working in a restaurant where my mother worked also. It was big enough, but it was all open planning so you could see everything that was going on. This is important later. So I'm working one fine summer day, and in comes entitled parent and her two brat kids, who look to be about 8 and 10. I set them down with their menus and bring over a glass jug of ice water, as most restaurants do. As I set the jug down, her kids ask if they can have juice instead of water, and I tell them that unfortunately we are out of juice. We have dispensers in our wall that you can get the juice out of. Entitled parent calls BS to this and demands that I fill up the glass jug with juice. I then point to the empty dispensers and literally show her that we are out. At this point, her kids are screaming that they want juice, and I try to calmly tell them that we don't have any. Then entitled parent picks up the glass jug and just lets it drop to the ground, and it just shatters everywhere, then looks me in the eye and goes, "Can I speak to your manager?" However, the manager wasn't in that day, and when he's not in, my mother is in charge. So my mother comes over and asked her what was wrong. An entitled parent goes hysterical, saying that I threatened her by shattering the glass jug when they asked for juice. She then says that she's going to press charges against me and she wants me fired. But as I said before, this restaurant was all open planning, and my mother had seen everything and knew that entitled parent was lying. I'm a tall girl, nearly 6'1", and I'm 17, so my mother wasn't exactly small either. I'd say maybe 5'11", which is pretty tall. So my mother literally bends down to entitled parent's height and puts on the voice that all mothers put on when someone messes with your kid and says, "I saw everything that happened, and I know that you're lying through your teeth. And you better leave before I press charges for putting my daughter at risk by shattering a glass at close proximity that could easily have hurt her. So help me God, if I decide that I want to press charges, let me tell you that you will never be able to show your face in a restaurant in this area again." My mother is pretty high up in the restaurant industry in my area, as she had been a chef in most of those restaurants. I swear, when entitled parent heard that I was the manager's daughter, her face turned so pale, I thought she was going to faint. She grabbed her kids and rushed out of the door, and thankfully, we haven't seen her since. Karen followed me at an airport because she thought I was a lost kid. This probably needs context before I start. Both my parents are divorced and live in two separate states. I live with my mom and grandparents in Nashville, Tennessee, while over school breaks, I visit my dad in Rochester, New York. I've flown alone since I was 5, and when I turned 13, my parents said it was okay if I travel without an escort on my layovers, as long as I text them when I'm boarding and when I land. Fair enough. This happened when I was 16. Now, I don't look my age and never have. There's a bad combination in my family, short jeans and a baby face. I was lucky enough to inherit both. To give you a rough image, I'm a 5-foot tall girl who weighs barely over 125 pounds with a baby face. Easy for people to mistake me as younger than I am. Well, flying was always the worst offense because I was alone. I also have bad anxiety and stutter a lot when I'm nervous, so it only adds to the age confusion more. I was coming back from New York and had a 2-hour layover in Baltimore. I decided to get some food at Chipotle. While I was eating at the food court, minding my own business and scrolling through my phone, this middle-aged, white, blonde woman with her two kids walks up to me. We'll just call her Karen. Karen. "Hi, honey. Are you okay?" Me. "Yes. Why ask?" "Well, you seem young and you're by yourself." Oh great, here we go again. This wasn't the first time this happened, so I calmly told her that I was fine and thanks for the concern. Well, apparently, Karen didn't like my answer. Her tone soon changed from a caring, concerned citizen to a demanding jerk. She told me I wasn't fine because I was a minor by myself and needed adult supervision to fly. She was correct about the minor part, but the supervision part was BS. I was flying Southwest, who allows anyone 12 and older to travel by themselves, but someone is still supervising you on the flight until you're 15. I did not need adult supervision to be in the airport past security alone, and I told her this. I politely asked her to leave me alone, and I understand the confusion. Karen was not having it.
You're lying.
Me? How?
I have kids, and I know the airport policy about minors.
Me? Clearly you don't. I've already said I'm fine. Can you please leave me alone?
No. Where are your parents?
Me? Doesn't matter.
Yes, it does. I need to complain to them.
At this point, I was getting annoyed. I didn't want to tell her about the fact that my parents were divorced, but back then I saw it as the only way for her to fully understand the situation and leave me alone. Me. Ma'am, I'm 16 years old. My mom is in Nashville waiting for me, and my dad is in New York. Neither of them are in this airport, and they both know I'm by myself and are okay with it. I'm allowed to have a layover by myself, and I'm not considered an unaccompanied minor when I'm 16 years old, according to the airline. Now please, leave me alone. Karen.
No, you're lying.
Me. How am I lying?
I know you're lying because I have kids. I know how rebellious they are, and you are definitely not 16 years old.
I was getting mad at this point. For one, what right do you have to tell me how old I am? And secondly, your kids look 7 and 5, a little too young to be going through a teenage rebellion. I stood up, put my food in my bag, and told her, I think I know how old I am.
Where's your proof?
I took out my driver's license. Looking back, I probably shouldn't have, but I was desperate for her to go away. With not only my birthday, but the fact I had one in the first place signified I was 16 years or older. I didn't want to show this lady my other information, so I let her see the birthday and nothing more. Karen wasn't going to swallow her pride and walk away. Karen.
That still doesn't excuse you from walking around the airport by yourself. How do I know you aren't running away from home?
I wanted to tell her that even if I was, it was none of her business. I repeated Southwest policy to her and told her that if she still didn't believe me, she could go on their website and check for herself or ask an employee. I then repeated for her to leave me alone or I'd get security. My bluff didn't seem to affect her. She said I wasn't going anywhere and I had to come with her and find my parents. I simply told her no and began reaching for my backpack. The Karen grabbed my wrist and started pulling me. I yanked my wrist away, grabbed my backpack, and started running. At this point, people were watching and her kids seemed distressed, but I didn't care. I made a run for my gate. Now, I'm not very athletic, but I'm definitely faster than this overweight single mom. I eventually made it to my gate and took a seat at one of the chairs. Still feeling uneasy, I told the lady at the gate what happened and that I was still shaken up. She understood and said if she saw a woman matching the description near the gate, she'd make sure she didn't come near me. And if she did, security would be alerted. Well, turns out my gut was right, and after about an hour, I saw her looking around the different gates. I told the lady and she nodded. She instructed me to get behind the desk as the Karen approached. Here's basically the conversation. Karen.
Excuse me? That kid behind you is not allowed to be in the airport by herself.
She turned to me and asked if I was an unaccompanied minor. I answered no. Worker. If she's not an unaccompanied minor, then she can be in the airport by herself. Karen.
She's lying. She can't be 16. She showed me a fake ID.
Worker. Oh, really? She turned to me and asked to see my boarding pass. I gladly handed it to her. She reviewed it and said it looked fine. She then asked to see what I showed the Karen. I handed her my driver's license and she also said it looked fine. Karen demanded that the woman at the desk hand me over to her so she could take me to her gate and find my parents. This scared me. I knew I wasn't going anywhere with this woman, but it didn't stop me from being scared. Worker. Ma'am, is this girl your kid? Karen.
No.
Worker. Then I'm afraid I cannot give her to you. I can assure you she's in good hands.
No, she's not, because she's rebellious and lying. I'm clearly more qualified to take care of her, considering I have kids and you don't.
That did it. At this point, I could feel a panic attack coming on. The nice woman must have noticed this. She told the Karen that either she goes to her gate and leaves me alone, or security will be called. Karen huffed and puffed, saying the front desk lady didn't know her own airline policies and she'll be calling 911 for endangerment and Southwest was going to get shut down for this. The lady at the desk only nodded. After Karen was done with her rant, she walked away before security could come. Before she left, the lady asked her name so she could file a complaint for her, an obvious lie, and she told her, "We'll just keep her name as Karen." The lady at the desk offered to find her gate, inform them of what happened, and made sure she didn't leave her gate to make me feel safer. I agreed, and we found out her gate was in the international terminal. Knowing this woman wanted to take me to a completely different terminal, the international terminal no less, made me even more scared, but I was assured everything was going to be alright. Her gate was informed about the situation, and they said that they would make sure she wouldn't leave the terminal once she arrived. It made me feel a lot better. I'm 19 now, and still haven't grown taller. I'm in college now and still fly by myself. I'm still a little shaken up from the whole thing, but I still fly on my own, but I make sure to carry around my ID and passport, and if anyone asks if I needed help, I'll quickly answer no and walk away. That may make me look more suspicious, but I don't care. I'd rather come across rude than have to deal with another crazy Karen. Man, this post was long. Thanks for reading all the way if you did. Have you ever seen anyone acting crazy at an airport? If so, what were they doing? Please let us know. Airports are actually one of my favorite places to freak out at. Am I the jerk for kicking out my girlfriend on New Year's Eve? We can all agree that 2020 was a bad year, particularly for my 29 male family. We lost our dad beginning of the year after he had a heart attack, and my little brother, 12, had no one to take care of him. Our mom passed when he was 3, so our dad was all we had left. I fought for custody and was appointed his legal guardian. Honestly, it hasn't been easy. We're still adjusting to these life changes, and my brother is taking it the hardest. For months, he was just not himself. Bad attitude, lashing out. I got him in therapy because I knew he was just hurting, plus stress of lockdown. His behavior has improved so much since then, even if sometimes there's days where he's withdrawn. Days before Christmas, he was feeling sad since it was our first holiday without Dad. That day, he asked to be left alone. We had a talk to discuss his feelings, and I gave him the space after that. My girlfriend was over that day, and I went out to buy groceries. When I got back, my brother was out of his room and helping out. I didn't think anything of it at the time. Yesterday, my brother and I were out having some guy time before going back home to get ready for New Year's Eve. My brother opened up about how grateful he is for everything, and he hopes that I don't change my mind about taking care of him. I asked why he'd think that, and he told me what happened. That day, when I was out, my girlfriend went to his room to tell him he needs to change his attitude and stop moping, her exact words, because he should be grateful I'm taking care of him at all, and that we can still hand him over to the state if we wanted to. I was furious about this and had to reassure him that was never going to happen because he really was worried about it. We went home, I confronted my girlfriend, and she didn't deny it. She told me it's true, and there was nothing wrong with telling him to stop acting like that when he should be grateful I gave up my life to take care of him. And the thing about giving him up isn't that big of a deal to her because it's not like I'll actually do it. I said she still scared him with that threat and told her to leave my apartment because honestly, I was far too mad and because I didn't want her to be near him right now. She started crying. There was more fighting, but she left in the end. It was just me and my brother for New Year's. Since last night, I've been bombarded with calls from all our friends for kicking her out, knowing she has no family and nobody else to spend the holiday with. Everyone has sided with her, and even my best friend says I may have overreacted by making her leave when she probably thought she was helping. They've heard my side of the story, but still think I was the jerk for making her cry and spending the new year alone. I'm having trouble seeing how I could be, so here I am looking for internet strangers to weigh in on this. Update. Okay, wow, this has gotten a ton of feedback. Thanks everyone for your kind and encouraging words. I might not have replied to a lot of the comments that made me smile, but just know that I read and appreciate them. I know I only posted this a few hours ago, but I've had a day to clear my head and really think about this. I talked to my brother because I wanted to know if she said anything else to him. Thankfully she hasn't, and we had another serious chat to remind him everything she told him is completely false. I would never in a million years give him up, and that shouldn't have been put in his head. Another thing I told him was that I'm grateful he's here with me. Without him, I wouldn't have made it through the year, and I thanked him for giving me the strength to keep going. Someone who DM'd me suggested reassuring him that he's not somehow ruining my life in case he feels any guilt for what she told him. Thank you for that suggestion. Now, I know you are all waiting on this news. Yes, I did break up with her. Thinking about what a lot of you said, talking to my brother about how this made him feel, and my own thoughts about how badly she acted, I decided that's not someone I want to be around, me or him. I can't risk her doing something like this again and ruining any progress he makes in therapy. I know many of you think I should have done it on the spot, but I wanted to make this decision with a clear head and not when my emotions were extremely high. She came by my place earlier and we talked outside. Her reaction was as bad as you'd expect, and she still believed she did nothing wrong, even after I explained it all to her. There was just no making her understand, and I told her it was over. I gave her a couple of her things that were lying around my apartment, and she left. My phone started going off like an hour later, so I had to put it on Do Not Disturb. That's all the drama I could handle for one night. I'll deal with my friends some other time. Honestly, I'm exhausted, mentally and emotionally drained right now. I think this weekend we'll do something to get our minds off this. I definitely need it after everything, and I know my brother does too. It's been a hard year already without all this extra drama. Anyways, sorry for the long update, you guys, but I didn't want to leave anyone hanging. I'm sure more comments will keep coming. I probably won't be sleeping much tonight, so I'll keep my mind busy by reading and replying to more of you. Thanks again for the support. What a crappy way to start the new year, but here's hoping for better things. Well, what do you think? Was OP the jerk or was his girlfriend? Please let us know.
Perhaps she was the one who should have gotten the warning. Seriously though, you should never tell a kid something like that.
Insane Karen loses it at my restaurant. I worked for close to 15 years at a small restaurant in my hometown. Mostly I did takeout and rang customers out. We are cash only and most people in the area know that. This took place in 2013. So one day a woman approaches the counter. She tells me, rather rudely, that she's paying and throws the receipt at me. I bring up her bill and tell her the amount and she hands me a Visa. I tell her cash only and she stands there with the Visa. I tell her again that we're cash only and she says,
"Oh no, honey, you can take cards. I come here every week and always pay with a card."
I tell her again we are cash only and she huffs and puffs, then digs through her wallet and hands me an American Express. I tell her again that we are cash only, and again, she tells me she's there all the time and always pays with cards. I tell her she has us mixed up and that there's an ATM in the lobby if she needs cash. The woman's face goes into this shocked expression, and she says to me,
"An ATM? Are you insinuating that I need money and that I'm poor?"
She storms out into the lobby to use the ATM after digging through her wallet to find cash. She stands at the ATM for a few minutes, then comes back in, telling me that she's not using a sketchy ATM because it's a bank she's never heard of, and it charges $3 for non-members. She then asks where a certain bank was in our area. It was a fairly large bank, but our town didn't have a branch, and I didn't know where there was a location around us. I tell her this, and she tells me I'm useless as an employee, and she'll recommend to my boss that he fire me. I tell her there's an ATM for Bank of America, not the bank she asked for, 5 minutes down the street. She thanks me and starts looking something up on her phone for a few minutes. She comes back up to the counter and tells me she's driving to the ATM. I tell her I need collateral from her, and she goes crazy, telling me I'm accusing her of being a thief. She then says that she'll leave her kid there as collateral. I tell her okay, thinking she's running to the ATM 5 minutes down the road. The girl takes a seat over in the corner at the front of the restaurant where we have a few chairs and a bench, and I go back to helping customers. I totally forgot about her until like an hour or so later when I realized she's still there. I'm a little worried because the Bank of America ATM is only 5 minutes away, but then I remember the mom asked about another bank. I quickly do a location search for it and the nearest branch is 45 minutes away. So I'm assuming that's where the mom went to. I keep checking up on the girl, making sure she's okay and asking if she needs anything. I ask her if she knows her mom's phone number so I can call to check on her to see how much longer. She gives me her mom's number and I call. Mom picks up after a few rings and I introduce myself and ask how long she'll be. She tells me she went to the ATM and while she was out, she decided to run a few errands while her daughter wasn't with her and that she appreciates us watching her daughter. I'm infuriated. I tell her we are not a babysitting service and I'm not watching her as I have a job to do. She starts going ballistic, telling me that something could have happened with her daughter while she was in my care. I tell her that she has 10 minutes to get here or I'm calling the police. She showed up 9 minutes later, talking on the phone about how her babysitter bailed on her while she was in the middle of running errands, threw the money on the counter, grabbed her daughter, and stormed out. What would you have done in this situation? Would you have called the police on her or not? Please let us know.
Definitely. She's going to be one of the worst mothers I've ever heard of.
I don't call him by his name either. Last night, my daughter came home from her job. She works retail in a nearby shopping plaza, with the sad news that their neighboring store, which specializes in kitchenware, is having a going-out-of-business sale. It was tragic news in our home, as my wife and daughter both share a passion for baking and cooking and shop there often, so much so that the owner, my wife, and daughter are on a first-name basis. Ever since my daughter was little, she was mommy's helper in the kitchen. It's been a running gag in our house the past few years that we give her a 5-pound bag of flour among her Christmas presents. Now, 17, she enjoys flying solo in the kitchen, and her pierogies are food not to be eaten, but experienced. My wife is feeling under the weather, so she gave me a list of things to look at, plus a surprise item, more later. I agreed to meet my daughter at the store when she finished work. My daughter had gotten there a little early, and I was a little late leaving the house, so she had already been in the store by the time I arrived. That's when the fun begins. Our cast, we've got sweetheart daughter, we've got obnoxious lady, and we've got nice store owner. I arrive at the store and find daughter chatting with the owner, commiserating over the store closing. Owner was feeling sad and appreciated daughter's sympathy, so I decided to shop for a bit and let them finish their conversation. I had barely made it 20 feet before I was overwhelmed by some of the choices. Nearby stood a middle-aged woman who, even with a mask, you could tell wore a perpetual scowl that curdled milk in a 5-mile radius. So I turned towards daughter and said, "Hey, sweetheart, I have a question." "Old lady."
"Sweetheart? That's not how you address a woman."
At this point, daughter hears the kerfuffle and sprints over, knowing that the gene that allows one to suffer fools gladly is only present in my wife's DNA. Owner wasn't with her, apparently having just begun ringing someone up. Me. But she's old lady, talking over me, raising her voice.
"You jerk! She has a name!"
Me. "Yes, I know. I was going to point out I gave her that name, after my grandmother." But she continued raising her voice.
"You address her politely as?"
Emphatically.
"Miss, or use her name."
Daughter, now arriving, putting her hands up. "Look, it's okay." Old lady, turning to daughter.
"No, it's not okay. You should not have to put up with—"
Daughter, raising her voice. "It's okay. I don't call him by his name either. I call him Dad." It's obvious that the embarrassment is now further exacerbating old lady's rage, and were I not suffering fools gladly challenged, I'd have just let things go. But as I mentioned, I lack that gene. Me. This is the part where a reasonable person apologizes. Karen just glares at me, determined not to give me the satisfaction before turning and walking away. Me. Yeah, I knew our little exchange was one reasonable person short. Come on, with emphasis. Sweetheart. Let's finish, with emphasis, mom's shopping list. We worked through the rest of the list, filling our basket and ferrying up the larger items to the counter. There are no shopping carts. Thankfully, Karen had gone by the time owner began ringing us up. Me, to owner. Oh, I forgot one thing. This is where the aforementioned surprise comes in. I hurriedly returned with the deluxe KitchenAid stand mixer that elicited a puzzled look from my daughter, as we already have one. Turning to my daughter. This one's for you. Mom and I figured that someday when you have your own place, you'll have your first appliance. Cue misty eyes for my daughter. Owner gave us an extra $50 off, which was yet another nice surprise. Speaking of baking, what was the last thing you baked or cooked? Please let us know.
I made a quiche last night, and boy was it good.
Am I the jerk for telling a mom on my flight I did not think she handled her kids' tantrums well? I was forced to take a flight across the Atlantic for work, which by itself put me in a fairly sour mood. A mom flying with a toddler was seated across from me. The kid had a really hard time adjusting to the changing pressure and ended up crying nonstop from takeoff to landing, an 8-hour overnight flight. Needless to say, everyone in the vicinity was absolutely exhausted and got no sleep. My earplugs were barely any help. Kids got some healthy lungs. I kept my mouth shut throughout the flight because no one asked for my opinion, but I will admit I was judging the parent. It was clear this was a social visit. Midway through, the mom took the kid's new toys out and kept trying to distract the kid with Christmas presents from grandma. When we landed, another woman decided to pipe in and compliment the mom on her patience and handling the situation so well. which she as a mom herself understood because it's so hard to travel when they are so young. Not going to lie, I rolled my eyes so hard that even with the mask on, it was clear I was in disagreement. She asked me why I'm making the face, and I responded that since she asked, I, and probably most others, don't think the mom handled the situation well at all. We've all had almost no sleep. It's a hard enough flight to take without the new protocols and no sleep. I then asked why she had to bring her kid to Europe in the first place, which is probably not a good idea, even during a normal year when he's that young. Some shouting from the mom and her newfound friend ensued, but I just shook my head and took the first opportunity to head for the exit. I'm usually not snippy with people, but hours of non-stop screaming got under my skin. Am I the jerk? Edit. In case you're wondering, I had to make an in-person submission with a regulator in the US, which requires being physically present in the country. Thank you, American bureaucracy, unwavering even during these wonderful times. Edit 2. I'm having a blast talking to all the entitled parents here. A few things that I know will enrage you, but truth hurts, as you know. 1. Traveling with a small kid when you know A. the pressure changes will cause the kid significant discomfort, and B. you'll affect everyone around you is extremely selfish. It's intentionally hurting your kid and making others miserable, and it's 100% your choice that led to the situation. 2. People will judge you for your selfishness. If you feel ashamed of your kid being disruptive, good, you should be. 3. No one owes you special accommodations because you have a kid. It's your choice, live with it. Others are entitled to feeling unhappy about the consequences of your entitlement. 4. Toddlers have no business on a plane. They have no concept of death. So if your excuse is last chance of seeing someone, as folks have posted, leave the kid with the other parent or bring them with you. But then don't you dare complain others are unhappy with your choice. See number 3. With this, I'm peacing out as I know I'm heading for the front page and also a ban from the mods from arguing in the comments. Happy New Year to all you're the jerks. Well, what do you think? Is OP the jerk or not? Please let us know. Oh, I can't wait to read the comments we get about this. Want me to move something without tying it down first? You sure? Okay then. Meet Bob. Bob is someone I know. Bob is a great guy. He has worked hard to support his family his whole life. I admire Bob because he can fix a lot of things on his cars, house, etc. He's almost entirely self-taught and has a lot of common sense despite not being book smart, which is why I was astounded that he had me do this. Bob can also be stubborn as heck and gets to be a real jerk when he is stubborn. Bob's wife found a beautiful roll-top desk at a yard sale. She had wanted one for years. Bob asked me to drive to the yard sale with my pickup. Sure thing, Bob. I don't mind helping you out a bit. Bob's wife was excited. Her eyes were gleaming. It was huge, really heavy, somewhere around 250 pounds and old. It was also a very nice desk. So Bob and I and the seller get it manhandled into my pickup bed. I grab straps and Bob snaps at me. We don't have time for that. Let's get it back to the house. I know darn well it isn't going to hold still and I tell him so. Yes, it will. It's a big, heavy desk. Drive really slowly with your hazards on. Now me, who actually paid attention to physics in high school, and you, dear readers, know where this is going. I protested. Let's lay it down or strap it. Bob overruled me. Bob's wife said something. No, he didn't want the desk marred up by straps. I said something again. Bob got upset and yelled, "Forget the straps! Let's go! Just drive like I said!" I said forget it. I did exactly what he said, despite it being my truck. After all, Bob had done a lot of free work on my pickup for me. I was doing him a favor, so whatever, let him be stubborn. We left the yard sale at 10 miles per hour with a dozen or so people staring at us, slack-jawed. Bob and his wife were in the Corvette behind me, so I was doing exactly what he said, driving really slow with my hazard lights blinking. We made it the few blocks to the main drag that will take us most of the way to Bob's house. I get in the turn lane to wait. The desk starts to shift. The turn lane turns green, and I edge out almost 5 to 7 miles per hour. The top heavy desk tilted, started to shift when the wheels on one side came up. Nothing you do at that point is going to work to stop it from tilting. Physics wins again. Bob's wife's new desk was destroyed in the middle of Powers Boulevard in Colorado Springs one warm spring day in 1993. I could hear her wailing through the open window. R.I.P. desk. Sorry, Bob's wife. I wanted you to have that thing. You were so happy. Edit. For those asking, the whole thing was anticlimactic, to be honest. We gathered the desk up and Bob attempted to repair it. It was broken into a lot of pieces though. My understanding is it worked for a bit, but when they moved out of state, they threw it out rather than trying to move it. My neighbor who took me to court because of noise my cat made. This happened about 4 years ago now, and still is one of the more ridiculous things to happen to me. I was living in San Diego, California at the time in a small apartment building with 7 or 8 units. I lived on the second floor. Our building was right near the highway overpass on the outskirts of downtown. We were also very close to the airport flight path, which made our neighborhood pretty loud. At this point, I had already lived in my apartment for just over 3 years. I decided to get a cat, got their permission from my landlord, and paid a pet deposit. When I got her through a shelter, she was probably about 3 months old. One night, I was watching TV when there was a knock at my door. I answered, and standing on my porch were 2 police officers, both with their hands on their weapons, both seemingly tense. They told me they had a noise complaint from my downstairs neighbor and that he thought I was on drugs and rolling a bowling ball around. It took me a few to understand what they were talking about, and then I laughed. "Oh, haha, that's probably just my kitten running around." They were not amused. They told me if they had to come back, they would have to do something, which is a pretty wild threat after finding out the noise was from a cat. I left a message with my landlord to let them know what had happened. The next day, my downstairs neighbor came to my door to apologize to me. He said he thought I may have been doing something illegal because his army intelligence friends told him that those noises he heard align with that kind of activity. That made zero sense to me, but I came to realize this guy wasn't all there. He said he was sorry and was happy I had a cat, and that he even had a toy he would give me. Cool, problem solved, right? About 2 weeks later, I had the police at my door again. This time, they were aware of the situation, and we all chuckled about how absurd the situation was. However, since they were called, they had to come. They just told me I'm doing nothing wrong, don't worry about a thing. Right around this time, my neighbor began hitting his ceiling anytime my cat ran around. It got me anxious to the point of having my cat sleep in a separate, smaller room so she couldn't run around. This only lasted a couple nights since she would cry the whole time. I just thought, whatever, I'm doing nothing illegal. We live in a city in a loud area. It's an apartment, etc. I'm not sure of the exact timeline, but about a week later, I had police at my door again. This time, it was the San Diego County Sheriff with a court summons. This old jerk neighbor was trying to get a restraining order against me because of the noise of a now 6-month-old cat. Court date comes around, and I had printed up about 15 to 20 pictures of my cat to show the judge. I was furious. My neighbor's evidence was handed to me, which was basically a list of dates and times that he marked down when he heard noises from my apartment. It's legit insane, and 5 pages long, and I still have it. The judge didn't want to hear any of it, just forced us to enter into court-appointed mediation. I'm fine with that, I just want things to improve. I received a call a few weeks later, after our court date, to let me know that the neighbor refused mediation and that we would have a second court date towards the end of the month. Throughout all this time, he was banging on the ceiling and scaring my cat. He started being malicious and would just whack the ceiling in the middle of the night, oftentimes waking me and causing my cat to go crazy and run around. Finally, the second court date was here, and at this point, I had already decided I would be leaving San Diego. It had nothing to do with this ongoing situation, but it was a light at the end of the tunnel for sure. We're in court, and the judge starts yelling at my neighbor for refusing mediation and wasting the state's money. I interrupted to say, "Just want to make sure everyone knows this is about noise my 6-month-old cat is making." I hear laughter from other people behind me in the courtroom. Neighbor pleads his case, says I'm harassing him and making too much noise. I repeat, "This is about noise my 6-month-old cat is making." The judge is clearly upset that this old man is wasting the court's time and said that we must enter mediation. I tell him, "I'm sorry, we shouldn't even be here. I'm moving out of state in just a few weeks. And again, this is about the noise a cat is making." Again, more chuckles from the courtroom. To this, the judge replies, "Oh well, if you don't end up moving, then you'll need to come back to court." I said, "Okay," and was ready to be done with all this BS. My neighbor tried to have pleasantries with me at that point, but I just ignored him and walked out. I wish there was some sweet revenge at the end, but really, I never spoke to him again, and my cat and I are living happily in an apartment where she can run around to her heart's desire and no one can tell her otherwise. Edit: my landlord did nothing to help me out. He just chuckled and said, "Oh yeah, he's a character." Steal my iPod? Forget your laptop. A story from 2007. Imagine being in high school, back in the latter days of George Bush, and finally buying that iPod of your dreams. After saving up your allowance and the money you made around the neighborhood doing random work and lifeguarding at the local pool. Yep, that was me. and I was that jerk 14-year-old who would always make sure that you knew I had one of the better iPods, one that could play video. It was the latest Nano, if I remember right. Simpler times. But every story needs an antagonist. My sister happened to find that role many times. We are very close now, but back then, it wasn't so rosy. She was a teenager as well, and spent most of those years resenting me. If I had something nice, forget you for having that. I was quite protective of my precious iPod. She raised quite the storm when my parents refused to buy her one. Your brother saved his money. We didn't pay for it. We are not stopping you from buying one too if you save your money. That was their attitude toward any luxury that us kids wanted, even up to that time when buying a first car was on the table. We each had to buy our own. It built character and taught responsibility. Well, that iPod goes missing one day at home when I knew darn well I had left it charging at the family computer. I left it unattended. My parents confirmed they did not touch it and all eyes were on my sister. I'll jump ahead here. As it turned out, she had indeed taken it and had one of her friends temporarily store it until the heat was off of her. She knew my parents would search her. After this unraveled, one of my buddies saw her with the iPod at school several days later. It was time for payback. Back then, I liked to think of myself as a bona fide hacker. That's right, I knew all about batch files and how to open command prompt. Don't cross me. You have no idea what I'm capable of. Yeah, anyway, we don't talk about those dark days, but I actually did know enough to copy and paste some destructive commands into scripts using del and regdelete commands and the like. In the days of Windows XP, this would essentially require reinstalling the OS. I also was aware of a program called bat2.exe, which could package your batch files and associated files it would call from the same directory into a normal .exe file, and you could pick an icon to slap on that .exe if you had the ICO file on hand. It doesn't take a genius, because as much as I thought I was one, I wasn't, to devise a plan here. I put a script together with the worst crap I could muster and gave it the Internet Explorer icon. This went onto my sister's computer, which was an old Pentium M laptop, which barely had enough power to load MySpace at the time. My hacker abilities allowed me to log into the administrator account by booting into safe mode or something and simply replacing the iExplorer.exe main file with my science experiment. I believe I had it to where it actually opened the real Internet Explorer in parallel, so I could deny this more easily. Fast forward to that magical moment. She's home from color guard practice and is ready for an evening full of crappy webcam photos that use every mid-2000s effect ever created. But before she can upload them, disaster. The screen resolution messes up, and the color profile is 16 colors for some reason. Random pop-up messages every few seconds. Microsoft Windows has detected a giant problem. Please consider a system upgrade, and stuff like that. Your hard drive is jammed with peanut butter. Restart required. The whole script plays out, and she's left with a paperweight until someone can get around to sorting it. Unfortunately, the computer guy and the family took quite a while to get around to it. My dad knew darn well that I had something to do with this, even if he didn't understand it fully. He made my sister apologize to me before I helped her with her laptop and made her buy me a new case for it, after she threw away the one I had to try and make it less identifiable. Hope 2021 is off to a decent start for you, feeling supersonic. Edit. To people asking what happened to the iPod, I got it back after learning from my buddy that she was going to have it on her. She was in a world of crap from my very traditional, discipline that kid parents, in addition to her laptop being a boat anchor for a few weeks. Do you remember iPods, or do you have no clue what they were? Please let us know.
I'm still trying to piece this all together. Was it like the first version of an iPhone or something?
Sorry, lady. I work here to fix your crap, but I'm not an employee. Hi, Reddit. I sorted old papers when I found some reminders of this story. A little explanation. I am a security expert. My main profile is facility security and fire prevention. On demand, I give information about work safety and environmental hazards. Enterprises hire me to find the risks they face. It means that at first contact, I have a first glance of my future client's site. We have a talk about what they need. Then I tell how many on-site days will that cost them. The task includes interviews, examination of regulations, and of course, assessment of the complex. It's not a job that can be done 100% in a suit and a tie. There are dirty places where I have to climb, and although I use a drone for high places, sometimes I have to climb industrial ladders, etc. For such occasions, I use military khaki coveralls with caterpillar boots, work helmets, and safety ropes if necessary. Will be important later. After the on-site days, I will prepare my report in the form requested. Mostly, this means electronic and or printed documents, but it's not uncommon for management to ask for a presentation in addition to the documents where questions can be asked. This is especially true when the company that commissioned me already had problems. This is also important later. On to the story. So I was hired by the owner of a company of rising activity. Big enough site, industrial buildings, heavy machinery, spectacular office building. The owner is a smart guy, a pleasant conversationalist, but the kind with whom you count your fingers after a handshake. We agreed on what he wanted to investigate, how many days it was for him, and what I needed to access, all for how much. The guy knew he wasn't throwing away the money he was paying me. Annoying thefts took place, and he did other things, but I refrained from talking about them because that would have oriented my research. At companies this size, in many cases, the security and the fire prevention is regarded as a kind of inner service provided by the facility management department. This was the case at this company too. When I begin a job like this, I always begin with the interviews of the security personnel. It's a good source of intel, and they will know me from day one, so no confusion on the following days. I went on with them, checked the camera system, burglar alarm, access control, fire alarm, etc. By the time I get to corporate policies, I have already found serious shortcomings, but the dirty part only followed. It was scheduled for the beginning of the second day to interview the head of the FMD, but when I showed up at her office at the allotted time, I only found her very embarrassed assistant there. The young lady said, "She had to leave and was only expected in the afternoon, but she was willing to help." I didn't tell her. It took me enough effort to overcome her initial embarrassment, but the conditions I could examine with her help were hair-raising. Third day was the day when I put my workwear, helmet, camera, tablet, and measuring instruments. The places I had to reach had access from the inside parking lot. Some of the parkings were marked for top management, who had company cars. The top management, four people, parked large but not ostentatious cars in the dedicated parking lots, alongside a few more modest company cars for lower-ranking managers. I was ready to climb a 20-meter, 65 feet, high industrial ladder, which takes two hands, so I turned the camera on. I needed a few seconds to take my gloves when I heard it. "Hey, you!" I look in the direction of the voice. It was a woman, very manager-like, very bossy, and the arrogance shown from her. She was some 5'6", approximately, fit and plastic with a modeled, expensive hairstyle. Apart from her, I was the only one in the parking lot, so it could not be a mistake to whom the kind words were addressed. Before I could speak, she continued in a commanding voice, "Grab my box and put it in my car. Come on, move!" Usually I am a polite, not to say chivalrous guy, but only with humans. She did not act like one by my standards, so I told her, "No, I'm busy. Do it yourself." And I began to climb the ladder. After a moment of dead silence, I heard her shout, "How dare you! Who is your boss? I will get you fired." I did not care about the ranting, but I was already more than 7 feet high on the ladder when I felt her grab my ankle. "Come back down at once. I am speaking to you," she shouted. "Listen," I told her, "I don't know you, but I presume you think that I am an employee here. I am not. Those people, working in the industrial buildings, they wear blue, janitors wear red, guards wear black. Probably they endure when you speak to them in such a tone. I do not. I'm climbing this ladder now. If you let go of my ankle, I will climb alone. If you don't let go, you will come with me." She was so surprised that she let go of my ankle. I climbed the ladder, but I still heard her huff and puff. She found someone else to load her car, then she went away. I noted the number of her parking. Sometime later, I edited my report. The owner scheduled a meeting with top management and Mrs. Name, who, as head of FMD, was responsible for the activities I had to investigate. At the time of the meeting, I arrived some 5 minutes early, but the four big bosses were already there. We were just waiting for Mrs. Name while we talked about nothing. In a few words, it was obvious that all four had read my report and had questions. Did it escape my attention that as a kind of in-house joke, bets were made on how late Mrs. Name would be? She arrived 10 minutes late. The owner won that bet. When the owner presented me, first she turned red, then white. She was the rude lady of the parking lot. When I began my presentation, she was aggressive and arrogant, but I left no place of doubt. So when I finished, she was completely devastated. In short, the company risked a fine of approximately $60,000 due to a series of irregularities, and thefts and material damage were caused by poorly written policies and faulty contracts. This could all have been written at Mrs. Name's expense, but the management felt they could have paid more attention. As always, my report included detailed suggestions for solutions, so Mrs. Name left not with the promise of dismissal, but with as much to do as she had never expected before. Even there and then, they asked me for a check back 3 months later. The check back was only one day, but I was with Mrs. Name for almost 7 hours that day, who was looking at my eyes no more than 5 times in total from that time. Have you ever had a manager be very disrespectful to you? If so, what did they do? Please let us know.
Every time they refuse to give me a refund, oh, how I can't stand them.
Cold hard cash? Sure thing. Prefacing this with the information that 1. My grandma has too much money. 2. My grandma has too much time. 3. My grandma has too big of a freezer. And 4. My grandma is petty as heck. The story. I have a cousin who's always wanted all sorts of interesting things for his birthday. Grandma loved that. Absolutely adored it. She gave him a turtle ocarina once, and I love it. That should explain her gifting for you. Now, as he grew up, he was less and less inclined to entertain Grandma's whimsical ideas and started requesting more mainstream presents. Grandma hated that and still found ways to make them whimsical. You want a guitar? Okay, but it'll have hippie wood-burning patterns on it. You want bedsheets? Sure thing, but they'll have tie-dye prints all over and be made of silk. If it was possible to make a gift whimsical, Grandma would do it. We all knew this and started getting awfully specific in what we requested until one year he threw his hands up and said, I don't know, just give me cold hard cash. Bad move. Very bad move. Grandma has chest freezers, the kind that are 4 feet deep, 4 feet across, and 12 feet long. Grandma also lives in a little foresty cottage plot, which means Grandma has access to all sorts of gardening tools and tinkers. So Grandma, being Grandma, found a big bucket, a ton of little plastic seed bags, and got to work. Cousin, of course, was very excited to finally get a normal gift and was grinning at Grandma, thinking that he finally won the game. That is, until Grandma brought out a 2x2x2 squared ice cube full of cash. Edited to add, measurements might be off. She used some sort of gardening bucket, and I was very angry when it happened. This story has been retold by Grandma so many times that I don't think she remembers the exact measurements either. It wasn't frozen together either. Oh no. Grandma had gotten creative and layered the ice gradually, freezing the cash solidly through the cube. This thing was icy white and oozing when brought into the room, and Grandma proudly announced that since he wanted cold hard cash, she gave him exactly that. This mad woman froze the equivalent of $1,000 in the ice in mixed money, which were tiny coins and bigger coins and bills in little seed bags near the center. It took the block about a week to melt because my cousin's birthday is in January and his mother refused to let it melt in the house for the fear of water damage, so it was set in their garage slowly melting. Edited to add, bathtubs aren't common where I'm from and they didn't have one. Moral of the story, don't mess with Grandma and her whimsical presents. You want me to run a fundraiser? I tried to tell you I wouldn't be able to? Okay, have it your way. This is kind of a 2-for-1 malicious compliance story, so it's going to be kind of long. So this happened back in September of 2006 when I was 16 years old. I was a Girl Scout, and our troop leader basically ran the troop like it was a doctoral level university course and made us, age 12 to 16, run most of the fundraisers to teach us responsibility. Well, in September, we were going to be selling steeply discounted magazine subscriptions through the organization as a last-ditch effort to earn money for a trip to London the troop would be going on in April of 2007. I had no intention of participating in the fundraiser since I knew I wasn't going to be able to sell any magazine subscriptions, nor would I be going on the London trip. However, the leader had other ideas and put me in charge of the fundraiser, meaning I would be responsible for handing out the packets to the 3 girls who weren't at the meeting, and I would have to tally up all the sales at the end of the fundraiser. I immediately protested the decision by our militant leader and told her I won't be able to run the fundraiser, as I have academic obligations on our meeting night for the entire duration of the fundraiser. The leader sneered at me and said, "What academic obligations could you possibly have for the next 5 Friday nights? Me. I'm in my high school's concert band, and weather permitting, we're scheduled to play at our school's soccer and/or football games, Each of the performances count as a full test grade, and missing just one performance will dock my grade a full letter. She sneered again and told me,
An extracurricular activity like band isn't an academic obligation.
Me, but ma'am, for me, concert band is an actual class like math or science, and I get graded for it. And I'm going to be studying music in college, so... Leader.
I don't care. You're still going to run the fundraiser.
A few of the other girls offered to run the fundraiser instead, but the leader was adamant that I would be the one running the fundraiser, and she snapped.
No, she needs to step up and take some responsibility for a change, even if she's not coming to London with us.
So, cue malicious compliance number one. I reluctantly agreed to run the fundraiser, and as luck should have it, the weather was perfect and clear for those next five Friday nights. So, instead of going to my Girl Scout meetings, I was sitting in the stands of my high school's football field, jamming with the rest of the high school band. The night I went back to my Girl Scout meetings was the night I was supposed to turn in all the paperwork for the fundraiser, as it was due the following Monday. And well, I had nothing to turn in, and my leader was furious with me. In front of everyone, and a few of the parents, she screamed,
Thanks to you, the fundraiser failed!
And I reminded her, When you put me in charge, I told you I wasn't going to be able to run it because of school obligations, and you still decided to put me in charge. So I did the responsible thing and put my academics before my extracurricular activities. This fundraiser didn't fail because of me. It failed because of you. After that, she looked like she took a bite out of a lemon, handed me her cell phone and said,
Call your mother to come pick you up. You're no longer a member of this troop. I'll change your status to Juliet.
A Girl Scout who isn't a member of a troop.
When I get home tonight.
Before I left, she sarcastically sneered.
Good luck trying to find another troop to join.
Cue malicious compliance number two. After school the following Monday, I called the Girl Scout Council office for my region and asked if there were any cadet/senior troops in county I lived in, and it turned out there was actually one in my hometown. I requested the leader's contact information and called her as soon as I got off the phone with the council office. I explained my situation to her and if it would be alright if I joined her troop. She said of course and gave me the troop number and troop crest. So later that week, I went to the Girl Scout Council store to pick up my new troop's insignia, and that Friday night joined my new troop. But it doesn't end there. Before I left that first meeting, my new leaders asked my mother and I if I wanted to join them for a Girl Scout seminar that was going to be held the next morning at a local hotel. I agreed to go, and the leader added, Just so you know, your last troop leader is going to be there. Is that okay? I don't know if you want to see her so soon after what happened. I grinned and said, Oh, I definitely want to see her. The aftermath that ensued that sunny but chilly Saturday morning was glorious. Once my troop leaders, the other two girls from my troop, and I arrived at the venue, we were led to a room where my former troop leader, her daughter, and another girl from my former troop were in. Turns out, they were also participating in the opening flag ceremony. The look on the leader's face when I entered the room wearing the full insignia of another cadet/senior troop just a week after she kicked me out of her troop was priceless. She stiffly said a curt,
Hello!
While the two girls were like, We're so glad you were able to join a new troop, and none of us blame you for what happened with the fundraiser. And to top it all off, guess who ended up leading the opening flag ceremony because she was the highest ranking girl taking part? Yep, yours truly. Have you ever been in Girl Scouts or how about Boy Scouts? And if so, did you like it? Please let us know.
Please let me know when the cookies go on sale again. They're so good.
My mom and stepdad stopped a class of kids from ever having hot chocolate again. So, I was making a delicious cup of hot chocolate earlier, and it reminded me of the following story. I think this belongs here, but I'm not quite sure. A few side notes before I begin for all the folks that don't live in the UK. 1. Year 6 is the final year in primary school. For Americans, I think that's like your version of middle school. I'm not sure though. 2. In my primary school, the deaf students had their own classroom for each year for extra support. They would still be included in our class projects and main subjects, English, math, and science, but they had their own classroom for other subjects, so they had more support. In my year, as there were 3 deaf kids, a couple of kids from the main class could go into the deaf class for extra support for them, and so they didn't feel isolated. 3. Green and black chocolate is very expensive. Good quality chocolate. It's around £2 a bar in shops. It's very rich, depending on the percentage of cocoa in it. You can get different percentages of cocoa, and that would be how strong it is. So 85% cocoa would be stronger than 80% cocoa. Now on to the story. The entitled mom in this story is actually my mom. Entitled stepdad is my stepdad. So, when I was in year 6, me and another girl were in the deaf class with the deaf kids. In our school, we were allowed to call our teachers by their first names. Not every primary school is like this, most actually go by surnames. So, the deaf kids' teacher was a lovely Greek woman. We will call her Nice Teacher. Nice Teacher was a very enthusiastic teacher. Once a week, she would make us students in the smaller class hot chocolate as a treat. It was the best hot chocolate I had ever had. Well, one week, Nice Teacher asked us students to chip in with ingredients. She gave each student an item to get. I had the task of getting the chocolate. However, she specifically asked me to get the green and black chocolate at 85%. After school that day, I asked my entitled mom and entitled stepdad when we were next going shopping. They both said they weren't sure. The next day, entitled mom said shopping was getting done whilst me and my brother were at school. He's 3 years younger than me. So I asked her about the chocolate. She said no, as it was too expensive. She then asked why I needed it, so I told her. Her and my entitled stepdad exploded. They said they weren't paying for it, and we can use cheap chocolate. I explained that I was asked specifically to get that chocolate, as it's what our teacher used. My entitled stepdad and entitled mom weren't having any of it. Instead of going shopping, they called a meeting with the head teacher, deputy head, and Nice Teacher. I don't know what exactly happened in the meeting, but when it was over, Nice Teacher came back into the classroom in tears. I knew what had happened. She stood in front of the very small class and told us all that due to a complaint, we weren't allowed to have hot chocolate ever again. I felt awful. I knew it was because of my entitled mom and entitled stepdad. Just as lunch was beginning, she pulled me aside and told the other kids to leave. She told me that my entitled mom and entitled stepdad complained, and she said because it really upset her, she didn't want me in her class anymore. She said she would keep Jess, but she will exchange me for another kid. I got so upset. I was only 10 years old at the time. I enjoyed being in her class. She was actually the reason I got so into Greek mythology. That is what she taught us in history. As far as I'm aware, all the time she was still at the school, she never made hot chocolate for the students ever again. Oh, don't worry. When I went into secondary school, my entitled mom and entitled stepdad were exactly the same. Whenever we had food tech, they would always moan about buying the ingredients, and if you didn't have the ingredients, you had to give a couple of pounds to the teacher to be able to use their ingredients. Well, my entitled stepdad and entitled mom refused to do that too. They had so many meetings with teachers, and it actually resulted in me being kicked out of the food tech classes. As I said, I'm not sure if this belongs here. My boyfriend said that entitled mom and entitled stepdad were being entitled a bit as they stopped the whole class from having it, but I'm honestly not sure. Edit. Wow, I honestly didn't expect this to blow up as it has. I wanted to do this just to point out a few things. 1. My mom and stepdad definitely could afford it. When my brother went into secondary school, they paid for all his food classes and even bought extra in case he needed them. I wasn't exactly liked by my mom. We have a very tainted relationship. That tainted relationship is part of the reason why I have developed BPD. 2. I have noticed everyone saying how much Nice Teacher isn't exactly nice. I understand that after what she did, but the reason I put her as Nice Teacher was because she actually really got me into Greek mythology. I'm a 22-year-old female, and even to this day, I will sit on the laptop and write up and research all different parts of Greek mythology. I even have my star sign, Sagittarius, tattooed on me. It was my first ever tattoo too, and I know the story behind it. Anything mythology-wise comes up, I can talk for hours. My boyfriend finds it adorable. I honestly don't know why. Edit 2. Another example of the favoritism. My mom and stepdad refused to pay for my passport and refused to pay any money towards school trips abroad. They also refused to pay for any of my hobbies. My granddad paid and took me to them, as he believed a kid should have hobbies. However, when my brother signed up for Navy cadets, but quit because we found out he only went for the trips abroad and didn't want to join the Navy, my mom and stepdad paid for everything for him. His passport, his uniform, deposits for any trips abroad, and even gave him well over £300 spending money. To those who have said about more than I'm letting on, I honestly don't know what happened in the meeting, but when school was over, my mom and stepdad picked us up, a huge grin across their face, and smugly my mom was like, "So, how was school? Make any hot chocolate today?" So I can only assume they went overboard. Who do you think is worse, the parents or the teacher? Please let us know. The parents are jerks, but the teacher, oh, I really wasn't expecting that. Am I the jerk for throwing away all my sister-in-law's wedding invitations? So I, 18, female, run a small business where I do calligraphy. I make red bubble stickers and do wedding invitations. It's not a large source of income for me, but it is nice to have a few more dollars coming in. I do hope to expand it one day because I put a lot of work into my designs and spend a lot of money on supplies. My brother, 25, male, got married to his girlfriend, 26, female, before the world went to heck. But there is an incident that she is still angry with me for and refuses to speak to me. For her wedding, she asked me if I would do the invitations. I was fine with doing them as a wedding gift, until I realized that she was having a 200-plus person wedding and wanted handwritten menus, invitations, and name cards, as well as table cards with facts about her and her fiancé. Of course, she picked the most expensive stationery and most elaborate designs that she could. I told her straightforward that I would not be able to finance this, me being a broke 17-year-old saving up for college, and that I could do it if I were paid, in which I would just give her a regular wedding gift. I told her that I would heavily discount the price to where she would only be paying for supplies. She told me that we would work out the details, to which I assumed she meant the price slash budget for supplies. Now, I finish all the invitations. Took me a significant chunk of time, but they are ready to go. I ask my sister-in-law to reimburse me for the costs, and she flips out and refuses to pay me, saying that I'm taking advantage of her and that I should be nice to her since the rest of the wedding was extremely expensive and that I was doing this to purposely exclude her from her new family. Here's where I might be the jerk. At this point, I had spent a lot of money and time on them, and I realized that there was no way she was going to pay for the menus slash table cards. So I threw away all the invitations I had made. It hurt to see my work go down the drain, but I did use the designs I created for them as examples on my Etsy site. By this time, it was too late to hire someone to make new invitations, so sister-in-law basically had to send emails instead of invitations. She managed to get printed menus for cheap though. Sister-in-law still won't speak with me. Mom is on my side, and brother is pretty neutral. He just wants me to apologize to keep the peace. Am I the jerk? Edit. So some have asked why I couldn't just give that to her as a gift instead of buying a separate one when I realized that I wouldn't be paid. The reason is that the stationery plus new pens cost way more than I would usually shell out for a wedding gift. I was going to buy her a good coffee machine, about $80, as that was the only thing I could really afford on my budget. The stationery and supplies would have cost hundreds of dollars on my end if I had gone through with making all the things without reimbursement. This would have wiped out virtually all my profits for the year. But luckily, I only ended up doing the invitations, so I wasted a lot less money than I would have if I had gone through with the project. Well, what do you think? Is OB a jerk for throwing them all away or not? Please let us know.
Not at all. Tell your brother he's in for a wild ride with that Karen he just married. Karen demands I load her dresser because I'm parked next to her. So today, I'm at Costco getting my meds, minding my own business. A lady and her son bought one of the dressers that Costco is selling. Fine, all good. They actually look pretty good. Mom decides the two of them can get in the car and refuse to help despite the two of them basically being the living embodiment of Styx. I mean, anything's possible, right? We all made it out through the queue to get outside, and they're about 8 to 10 steps behind me. Mom and son are bickering because son knows she's not strong enough to lift aside. Mom won't have it. I get closer to my car, only to find a young family struggling with a 2-year-old refusing to go in its seat. Inconvenient, given it's 95 degrees before the heat reflecting properties of asphalt. But whatever, I'm not in a rush. Kids will be the monsters they will be. Mom and son try to lift the dresser to no dice and to my immense humor. I've had to deal with her at work before, and she isn't the nicest person. Sadly, she recognizes me at some point and demands I
get over here and help my son load this.
I pretended not to hear her and went about watching the kid just mess around with his dad trying to buckle him in. 10 for 10, would watch again with popcorn. Mom decides to tap my shoulder to get my attention.
Cue, help my son load this dresser.
Again. No, as my answer isn't taken well and she had a freakout moment. Even so far to threaten to return the tree she bought from us because I was being rude. Good luck with that, lady. You and your son can't lift a 150-pound dresser. Good luck lifting that 800-pound autumn blaze maple now that it's had plenty of time to root in. I finally look at the son and see his obvious shame that his mom is acting like a 2-year-old, not wanting to go into the car seat. I agree to help the kid, so long as mom doesn't touch it because she will tip the box too much. Gotta keep in mind, I'm 6'2" with a 6'6" wingspan. I know, long arms. And a bit of a brute from shifting many 300 to 700-pound trees by hand. We lift the dresser into the truck bed without too much issue, despite the fact I took about all the weight. Mom then decided I need to follow them home to help offload the dresser. Heck no, lady. Heck no. It was big enough of an r/I-don't-work-here-lady moment to even load the thing, let alone ending up back at your house to offload it. The dad finally managed to get the baby buckled up, and I hopped in my car and drove off. Ended up that she called my job to complain that I was rude and not helpful. Sales staff know I'm off on Mondays, my only day off after all, and ask what it was about. Lady, I guess, decided to admit that she was trying to bully me into helping her, and it got laughed off. Can't wait to see what comes of this. Cheers, mad lads and mad lasses dealing with r/I-don't-work-here-lady issues. Edit 1. I'm aware I shouldn't have caved and helped her, but at the time it seemed like a good thing to help the kid with her. I have one of these entitled jerks as a stepmother. Kind of hard for me not to sympathize. Am I the jerk for embarrassing my wife in front of our friends by not going along with her lie? When my wife and I got married, we were both working. Once our first kid was born, she wanted to quit. Completely her decision. I started working more to compensate, and she started taking care of the house and the kid. I'm a pretty clean person, and I help whenever I could or if she asked. I'm an involved parent. Then we had another kid, and I started working even more. At the end of 2019, my wife flew to her home country to visit her parents. Airports were shut down, and all the flights were canceled before she could come back. There was a lot of red tape to unravel here, and we couldn't get her back home until May. Like I said, the only reason I didn't do household work was because I was working too much, and I discussed that with my wife, and she was also okay with taking care of the household. I've lived alone for several years, and until she quit her job, I always did my share of everything. I am pretty far from helpless. At first, I freaked out a little, as I couldn't work from home, and I had kids, 7 and 2, to take care of. In the end, I figured it out. I was stretched a little, but it was nothing unmanageable. My wife came back home in the beginning of May 2020. She was very happy to be back home, and we were all happy to have her back. There didn't seem to be any problem. A few weeks ago, we are having family dinner at our house with one of our couple friends when my wife told them that I was miserable without her, that the kids were miserable, that the house was a disaster, that she had so much stuff to clean up, etc. She basically said that I was helpless without her, and that I couldn't take care of anything while she was gone. I kind of chuckled awkwardly. I told her that the kids and I were definitely miserable sometimes because we missed her, but nothing other than that was true. I told her not to lie about me or my ability to take care of the kids. After dinner, she was extremely mad at me and told me that I was a jerk and that I should have just played along. She told me that she felt awful that I could manage everything without her, and she felt that we didn't need her and that she was insignificant. I obviously tried to tell her that it wasn't the case, but she kept yelling at me and made me sleep on the couch. Here's the thing. Just because she isn't employed doesn't mean she can't work / doesn't know how to work. Similarly, just because I don't do things now doesn't mean I can't do it. I think it's demeaning to have me pretend that I am a man-child who has to be babied and doesn't know how to do basic things and can't take care of my own kids just so that she can feel better about herself. I don't think it's right to portray me as an incompetent person because she feels insecure. However, she is still really upset, and I'm not so sure anymore. Am I the jerk? Am I the jerk for not going along with the lie? Well, what do you think? Is OP the jerk or not? Please let us know.
Reminds me of when I go somewhere and I come back to this pigsty.
Sure, Karen, whatever you say.
Entitled Mom sells me a broken guitar because her baby can't play it. This story happened some years ago while I was living in the East Coast. I was driving back home from a friend's house and decided to take a detour through one of the more nicer neighborhoods because it was the beginning of fall and I'm just a sucker for the scenery. While driving, I just so happened to find another thing that I go crazy for, a garage sale. With me having some money on hand, I decided that this was fate and pulled over to check it out. At first, I didn't really see anything special, just the kind of stuff you would expect to see at any garage sale. Old furniture, clothes, DVDs, and other small items. But then, in the corner of my eye, I saw something that I just didn't expect to see. A guitar. I went in for a closer look, expecting it to be some kind of cheap beginner guitar. The kind with a brand name you don't recognize. But no! What stood before me was an actual Gibson Les Paul. Side note, to those who don't know, Gibson is a very prestigious guitar brand name, and Les Paul is probably their most famous model type. This model of guitar is legendary for being the weapon of choice among god-level rock stars. For example, Slash from Guns N' Roses, or Ace Frehley from Kiss. Now back to the story. She was beautiful. And yes, I refer to guitars as she.
She was golden color with the white trim and looked kind of old, but in really good condition. But what got me in an actual state of shock was the price tag. It said the price was $50. I couldn't help but think that this person selling it forgot to add another zero to the end of the price, as well as a one to the beginning. So I picked up the guitar and went up to the woman handling the sale to ask her about it. She didn't really look like a typical entitled parent, but her attitude and body language just radiated entitlement. It was like her aura was almost made out of pure smugness and hatred for the working class. Just by talking to her, I couldn't help but feel that she was the kind of soccer mom that you would expect to yell at the coach, as well as the referee, other parents, and maybe some of the kids. But I digress. We've got me and we've got entitled mom. Me. Excuse me, ma'am. Can I ask you about this guitar? The price says it's $50. Is that correct? Entitled mom.
Yes, that's correct.
Me. Well, that's an unusually good price. Is there a reason for that?
Yes, it's broken. I figured someone could use it like a decoration in their man cave or something.
Hearing that just broke my heart, but it also got me curious because I couldn't find anything physically wrong with the guitar. No cracks or any other signs of damage. I started asking more questions, thinking maybe I could fix her later. However, it was at this moment that any and all logic began to die and roll downhill away from me. Me. Can I ask what's wrong with it?
Yes, my baby can't play it.
Excuse me?
My son, he says it's unplayable.
Me. Oh, does he work with guitars, like a technician or something?
Oh no, he can't work. My baby is only 12.
Hearing that stunned me for a quick second, but I then decided to try to give the benefit of the doubt. I don't know this kid, so maybe he was one of those young musical virtuosos who got accepted to Juilliard early or something. Me. So, I take it your son is musically talented?
Oh, very much so. He plays that Guitar Hero game all the time.
Me. What?
Oh, you know, that game where you play music. He's constantly playing that game and is always getting the high score on it.
I kept a straight face, but my mind was turning into that meme of the woman trying to do math. Me. So, because of that, you got him a guitar?
Well, of course. When you have a child as gifted as mine, it's important that you nurture their gifts.
Me. So you think he knows what he's doing?
He obviously knows what he's doing. So if he says it's broken, it's broken.
Listening to her talk made my brain hurt, but it also helped me decide to take the chance and buy the guitar. While paying, the woman went on a long and insane rant about how the guitar was actually a gift from the kid's late grandfather from the dad's side of the family, and how he must not like her son because he gave him an old hand-me-down guitar instead of a brand new one. Hearing all this legitimately upset me, but I just decided to keep my mouth shut and leave. After getting home, I immediately took the guitar, plugged her into my amp, retuned her, that was all the maintenance she needed, and played a few notes and chords. To my amazement, she sounded perfect. It felt as if her soul was singing the praises of freedom. I spent the rest of the day playing and tripping out that not only have I purchased my first ever Gibson Les Paul, but I also only paid $50 for it. But the story doesn't end here. A few weeks later, I made a friend at a party who was an actual guitar technician. I told him my story, and he said if I wanted, he could appraise my guitar and tell me her true value. I took him up on the offer, and the results blew me away. It turns out my baby was a vintage Les Paul from 1973, retailing at well over $3,000. He then asked me if I were interested in selling, but I told him there was absolutely no way I'm ever letting go of her. But the story still doesn't end here. Shortly after getting my baby appraised, I get word from a friend who turns out works in the same office building with the husband of Entitled Mom. She updates me about what she learned, and apparently Entitled Mom's husband is of course righteously furious. It turns out, not only did Entitled Mom sell a very expensive guitar for just $50 that was a gift from his father to her spoiled kid, but she also sold it without him knowing. Not only that, my friend informs me that Entitled Mom has also been looking for me. My friend tells me that Entitled Mom wants to find me so she can demand the guitar back, not offer to buy it or even pay back what I paid. She wants to demand that I give it back for free, because apparently I scammed her out of a priceless family heirloom and robbed her kid's ability to play music. My friend said she didn't say anything about her knowing me, but then asked me if I wanted her to say anything to them about who I was. I tell her absolutely not. If she wants a guitar, she can buy a new one with the money I gave her, just like she planned. And I agree that this guitar is a family heirloom, but it's my family heirloom. Sorry, entitled mom, but if it means anything, if you're reading this, I named her Karen. Have you ever played a guitar? Or how about any other music instruments? Please let us know. Stop messing with my thermostat. Dude, this is not your house. For the last months, I've been working as an intern in the HR department of a middle-sized company, and while it has been mostly an uneventful job, there have been some really peculiar moments. Most people up north may be suffering from a white Christmas, but down here in the equator, we are melting from the heat, and in a highly humid town like the one I live in, it feels like the Amazon rainforest. Well, maybe that's because we are actually in the border of the Amazon rainforest. This would make you think any building will have their own air conditioning units working full-time on full power, no? Well, not if Mr. Jeremy Johnson, our protagonist, could prevent it. Every day, Jeremy was the first to get in the building, enter the office he shared with the other five guys, and set the thermostat to a not-so-refreshing 25 degrees Celsius, 77 degrees Fahrenheit. The device was on his workplace, so he basically had full control over it. When any of his coworkers complained about it still being really hot, he would set it to 20 degrees Celsius, 68 Fahrenheit, for about 10 minutes and then return it to his loved 25. If they changed it themselves, he would set it back once they returned to their desk. As childish as this may sound, this game lasted for about a month until an HR representative, your sweet narrator here present, had to intervene because this was getting out of hands. Formal complaints were done, and the screaming matches were getting worse and worse, with people in other departments commenting on the issue. So, normal first step. I interview the five guys, and they describe the problem I just told you about. Cue to the funny part. My interview with Jeremy. I will try to recreate it the best I can, although I may be a little biased. Me. Hey, Mr. Jeremy. I am Latina Cinderella from HR. How are you? Jeremy. Fine. Me. So, let's cut to the chase. About the thermostat.
What about it?
Me. I described to him the complaints against him. Having said this, we need to find a solution.
A solution for what? The only problem here is that these kids can't handle a little bit of heat.
A detail I forgot to include is that while Jeremy is in his early 40s, his coworkers are in between 24 to 30. Me. Yeah, but that's the reason we have the air conditioning, sir, so that the workers can be as comfortable as they can.
It's expensive.
Me. Our energy budget is able to cover for it. That's nothing you should worry about. In case we need to make cuts, we will tell you.
Well, I can't handle the cold. It triggers my allergies.
Me. Maybe we can arrange a place change so that you are not close to the air vent and, I don't know, maybe you can bring a thin sweater so that you don't get too cold.
I don't like sweaters. I'm fine with the way I have the thermostat. Why should I change it?
Me. Because you are not alone in your office, Mr. Jeremy, and we can't let this fight affect your work environment.
I really don't get all the drama. I keep the same temperature at home, and none of my kids complain or are allowed to change it. It should be the same here.
I think at this point, my face just made the most what-the-heck expression imaginable, because I could not believe the argument he had just said. Me. Sorry, mister. This is not your house. This is your workplace, and those are not your kids, but your adult coworkers.
Then they should act like it.
Me. Okay, that's all I needed to hear. We will tell you what measures would be taken. Have a good afternoon. So, after that weird conversation, I talked to my supervisor, and in the end, it was decided that Mr. Jeremy had two options. One, change places in the office and leave the thermostat in the hands of the other guys, meaning he needed to deal with the cold. Or moving to our backup office, basically an adapted supply closet, basically used for extra personnel we sometimes hired, also used occasionally as a file warehouse, and whose only ventilation was a small fan, no windows. Surprisingly enough, Mr. Jeremy chose the first option, and while he is constantly nagging about his cold feet, at least they are not fighting anymore. Speaking of thermostat, what do you like to leave your thermostat on? Please let us know.
I like it really cold.
I sold a guy an arcade machine at a store I don't work at. So, my wife's Christmas present was a gift card to a well-known sporting goods store to get herself new shoes. We went in today, and at the front desk of the store were a few of those arcade one-up machines that have become popular lately. I asked my wife if she'd be okay with me playing some Pac-Man instead of helping her find shoes. She agreed, and don't worry, I used hand sanitizer before and after playing. While in the middle of my game, I'm approached by another guy. I'm in my late 20s, he's older than me, but I don't think he could have been older than 45. He casually walks up to me and says, "Having a good game?" Me: "Yeah, actually I'm not doing too bad." Him: "I bet it plays terrible compared to the real thing." Me: "Actually, no, you'd be surprised, it's pretty darn close." Him:
"Really?"
Me: "Yeah, the code is the same and the picture is pretty clear, so the only thing to worry about is input lag, and that's really low." Him:
"Wow, I didn't realize these were so good. Too bad they only play one game."
Me: "Actually, this one has about 10 games installed."
"Really?"
I lose intentionally so I can give him the grand tour of the machine. "Yeah, see? When you boot it up, you can pick between all these games, and if you want more, these things are really easy to modify to add more." Him: very interested by now.
"You can modify these?"
Me: "Yeah, in fact, these arcade 1-up machines are popular choices for arcade enthusiasts who want to play MAME but don't want to build their own cabinet, because these are affordable and leave a small footprint in your house." Him:
"So, the price is fair?"
Me: "I certainly think so. I mean, speaking for myself, I built my own cabinet." I pull out my phone and show him the pictures. "But in all, it costs a bit more than this does. So if you don't want to build one, and you're okay with the limitations this gives you, I think it's worth it." Him, after a pause:
"You know what? I want one!"
This was pretty cool to hear, but it crossed my mind that he might have thought I was an employee trying to pass a sale on him. "That's great, sir, but I should warn you, I don't actually work here. See, my wife needs shoes, and I'm just playing games to pass the time." He didn't seem to mind.
"I'll go find someone to help me buy this then."
He turns and leaves, and calls behind his shoulder,
"Have a good game."
That was about 10 minutes ago. As I'm writing this, he and an employee are busy loading the box into his truck. Am I the jerk for backing out of an agreement I never made? 2 months ago, my dad, 54, male, approached me with an opportunity to buy a female Labrador puppy from his friend, let's call him Joe, who shows and breeds pedigree Labradors. According to my dad, Joe was offering me the Labrador puppy for a heavily discounted rate, $80, because I was his friend's daughter. Nothing else was mentioned to me about why the puppy was so cheap, but I assumed my dad's friend Joe was just being generous. Looking back, I was definitely naive, but I had been wanting a Labrador pup for a long time, and the offer was just too good to pass up. That same day, I drove over 2 hours to Joe's farm to collect my 3-month-old Labrador puppy and signed the paperwork transferring the ownership of the pup to me. Joe never mentioned anything else about the terms of the sale, and I never signed any other paperwork or contract regarding further terms. I want to stress that in the period directly after the sale, neither Joe or my dad discussed with me the apparent extra terms I had supposedly agreed to. Until recently, I mentioned to my dad that I had booked Jennifer, name of pup, to get fixed next month, and my dad immediately told me I had to cancel. He went on to explain that he had agreed, on my behalf, to allow Joe to use my Labrador to breed more pups for him to sell. This is apparently why I was able to buy Jennifer for such a discounted rate. I was shocked, but frankly not surprised, since my dad has a long history of neglecting to mention important details and lying by omission. As far as I'm concerned, I never agreed to those terms, so I'm not bound to them. Dad and Joe may have had a verbal agreement, but I am the legal owner of Jennifer, and there was no verbal or written agreement between me and Joe, so I don't care. I called Joe and made it crystal clear to him that I absolutely was not planning to breed her, let alone give him the puppies to sell. He was upset, called me a few choice names, and demanded I pay back the difference between the discounted rate and the normal rate for Jennifer. I refused, because I legally own the pup now, and the sale is over. If he wanted me to breed my dog, he should have talked to me about this personally because I was the buyer, not my dad. Joe is apparently fuming. My dad is angry because he doesn't understand why it's a big deal, and other extended family members who know Joe think I'm being a jerk and should at least pay him back the difference. But I honestly just don't feel like I'm obligated to. It's their fault, especially Joe, for not mentioning these extra terms to me before the sale. He's the seller, and he should know better when conducting his business. Also, according to the agreement, I would have to breed my dog whenever Joe wanted, so I'm guessing non-stop. Plus, Joe would not have to pay for her medical expenses and all that would come out of my pocket. Hard pass. Once a bookseller, always a bookseller. Except to entitled jerks. This story is a few years old, but still a solid block of what the heck in my brain. Characters. We've got Bob, Karen's poor husband who doesn't do much at all. We've got Blackbeard, the manager. He was there when I worked there and is known for being a no-crap-taking guy. And we've got me. Backstory. I was a bookseller for almost a decade, but left for a high-paying Monday through Friday 9-to-5. I had loved my job. After I left, I still frequented the bookstores in the chain a lot, browsing shelves, checking out new titles, and catching up with old coworkers. The story. I'm in my old store. It's in an area that has access to a number of posh neighborhoods. It's been maybe 3 to 4 years since I left. The staff has gone through its sixth turnover, and only a small handful of employees that I worked with are still there. I'm in jeans, my university sweatshirt, had my purse over my shoulder, and my cell phone out, with earbuds in with bands like Five Finger Death Punch, Die Antwood, and in this moment lined up in for my ears. Very clearly a customer. There is no uniform here, just business casual clothes with a lanyard that holds a name tag. I'm perusing through the sci-fi and fantasy section. I have 2 books selected already, and I'm looking for a few more. My limit is 5 books, or no more than $60. One of the employees, one that I don't know, comes up to ask if I need any help. I say that I do, and tell him that I used to work there, and I'm looking for a couple more books. I tell him what type of books I like, and he recommends a few good titles. We end up chatting more about the genre in general, about the classic authors, etc. I thank him, and he goes on his way, and I'm 2 books richer. I move on to the mystery section, and I picked up an empty basket to put my books in, when I feel it. That hard few pokes, executed by a bony digit tipped with a long acrylic nail. Then the words. Karen.
Excuse me?
And there she is, that dark root blonde bobbed hair, the 3/4 yoga pants matching workout top, pristine white sneakers, wristlet purse, and the latest iPhone. Her husband is a goose-looking, tired Ken style of a man, hands in his pockets. Me, taking out an earbud. What? Karen.
That's not how you greet a customer. So rude.
Me. Look who's talking. Karen.
What did you say to me?
Me. What do you want? And I don't work here, by the way.
Yes, you do. I heard you chatting with that other employee over there. I need this book.
She presented her iPhone that indeed had a picture of a book. Me. I don't work here, lady. Back the heck up.
What did you say to me? How dare you? You're required to help me. I'm a paying customer.
Me. I'm not required to do anything. I turned my back on her and moved further down the aisle, hoping she'd take the hint. Nope. Instead, she grabs the back of my hoodie and yanks me back. Me.
What the heck is your problem, lady? I don't work here. I'm in jeans and a sweatshirt. I have my purse. I was listening to music, for goodness sake. I know you work here. I've seen you working here before.
I used to work here, years ago, but I don't anymore, so back up.
You're still obligated to help me. It's part of your code.
Me. Say what?
Your code! You have to help me, or I'll speak to your manager and get you banned and fined.
I'm staring now at this bleach blonde lunatic, then at her husband with a, is she serious with this crap? Look, he can't even look at me. Me, thinking about Reddit here. Fine, do it. I'll get a manager. Let's see who gets in trouble. I flag down an employee and ask for a manager. When they ask why, I tell them we just need a manager. The employee shrugs, gets on their portable store phone, and calls for a manager, who comes over. We'll call him Blackbeard. Blackbeard.
Hi, what seems to be the problem?
Karen, of course, starts her spewing, yammering on about how I insulted her, called her names, and refused to assist her. She plays no tears, just rage. Blackbeard.
Ma'am, please, there's no need for that kind of language or that level of volume.
He turned to me.
Miss, can you tell me what happened?
I gave him my version, trying to hide my smirk. Blackbeard, he's staring at Karen now like she's an idiot.
Ma'am, she doesn't work here. I can help you find your book, but you can't go around harassing people, be they employee or customer, even if they used to work here.
Karen said some other things. Blackbeard.
Ma'am, you have 3 choices. 1, pipe down and I'll help you out. 2, keep going and I'll have you removed and banned. Or 3, just leave. Your choice.
Karen and Blackbeard had a staring match that lasted a good 15 seconds. Karen left with a scowl, and Blackbeard and I shared a small high five. I finished up my shopping, Blackbeard letting me use his employee discount. I went to a restaurant next, ate and read, And as I enjoyed a cheesecake dessert, I wondered what kind of code Kieran was talking about and where the heck she had heard it. The end. Speaking of books, what was the last book you read? Please let us know. Am I the jerk for blowing up on my wife? For spending $8,000 on a motorcycle for my stepson? I've been with my wife for over 6 years. I have a 17-year-old stepson and a biological 22-year-old son. The family had ups and downs just like any other family. My son is getting married in February. I have put some money aside to help him out as a gift from me for his wedding. I've already talked to him about it, and he and his fiance said they'd appreciate it very much. My son deserves it, because before his mom passed, he took over her care and spent nights at the hospital with her. He cried many, many times because her passing broke him. I'm glad he found happiness again. My stepson is a motorcyclist. It started off as a hobby. He has posters of all kinds of motorcycles, pictures of famous racers and motorcyclists. He has a group of friends he calls brothers, and they ride together and wear some kind of bracelets that represent the group. He always does 3D art and logos, which I find stunning, to be honest. He's talented, no question about it. Anyway, before Christmas, his mom told me she wanted to get him a motorcycle as a Christmas gift, and he'd love it so much. I told her I can't afford it, and that maybe she should think of another gift for him. Everything was fine until Christmas Day, while we were exchanging gifts. My stepson received a small box from my wife that had a key in it. We were confused. She told him to go outside, and we all followed, and then I saw a brand new motorcycle in the driveway. I started wondering where she got the money. I didn't bring it up right then and there. I waited a bit. I asked my wife, and she told me that she took $8,000 from the account to buy the motorcycle. I lost it. I blew up on her and asked if she was kidding me. $8,000. That's the money I put aside for my son's wedding. She said that I needed to calm down, but the money was already gone. My son showed up and asked what was wrong. I couldn't tell him his stepmom took the money that was meant for him to buy an expensive motorcycle that I'm sure my stepson will throw in the garage just like he did the old ones in a very short time. So far, he had two motorcycles that ended up being damaged. Those motorcycles cost us so much money, other than paying for spares and parts that needed repairing. I told my wife she has 2 days to return the motorcycle and get the money back, and she defended herself, saying she can't do that because it would be devastating for my stepson and that he'll resent me if he knew I made her return the motorcycle. I told her that I was ready to talk to him and explain if that's what it takes, and she started crying, saying I was okay with my stepson's spirit crushing like that. I told her it was her fault for taking money in the first place without telling me. She went upstairs and stayed there the entire night. I haven't even talked to my son yet, and it's so exhausting since my wife says I'm being cruel to my stepson. Problem is, she says my stepson will resent me if I return the motorcycle. Well, who do you think is the jerk? OP or his wife? Please let us know. Am I the jerk for not defending my husband when my parents berated him? So, what happened has caused a huge conflict, and most of my family members have pretty much cut contact with me. I'm female, 28, and my sister, who's 25, miscarried last week. It was so horrible for her and her husband, as this is the second time that this has happened to them. My sister spent the following days at her home, feeling exhausted and depressed, and I called her to check on her, but she kept the conversation short. My mom was very concerned and decided to invite her and her husband for dinner on Sunday to get her to feel better, and also since the family wanted to see my sister and support her. So mom thought having a family dinner was a good idea. On Thursday, I found out I was pregnant, but I didn't tell anyone, thinking the time wasn't right, so only me and my husband knew about it. We got there. My husband was surprised to see the whole family was there, saying he didn't expect that. I sat with my sister before dinner. She looked like a mess. We cried together, and I absolutely felt sorrow and how she was struggling with her loss. After that, we all started having dinner. While everyone was talking casually, my husband called for everyone's attention, said he wanted to take a minute to announce that I was pregnant and that we had found out this week. I was shocked, speechless. Everyone started congratulating me while my sister got up and literally walked outside. Her husband followed her. My parents were the only ones who didn't move. They just stared at me and my husband disgusted. A few minutes later, her husband came back inside to get her bag and they left. Things got quiet. My aunt, cousin, and her family started leaving. I wanted to leave, but my dad told us to stay because he wanted to talk to my husband. I knew there was going to be a crap show since my husband has a history with him. My father lost it. He yelled at my husband and called what he did insensitive and inappropriate. My husband wanted me to defend him, but I just sat there while my dad was raising his voice for being disrespectful and inconsiderate and a jerk. My husband responded with bringing up past issues, saying they were playing favorites, and told them that because of this, they will never see his kid. He got kicked out by my dad. We got home, and my husband blew up on me for not defending him, but I yelled at him that what he did was very wrong, and that my sister will most likely never talk to me again, thinking I was behind this. We argued for a few minutes, and he told me to buzz off and slam the door, to go be with his buddies after I told him to fix his anger issues. Info. I told my husband to not tell anyone about my pregnancy, but he thought since the whole family was there that this was a perfect time. He completely disregarded everyone's feelings. I know he's my husband, but they're my family, and they were hurt. My dad was hurt. Well, what do you think? Should OP have stood up for her husband or not? Please let us know.
I think leaving him might be a better option. Even I wouldn't do something like he did.
Am I the jerk for telling my roommate her aspirations of becoming an influencer are pathetic? I've lived with a couple for a little over a year and a half. I'm in my early 20s, they're in their early 30s. The boyfriend works 2 minimum wage jobs, at least 50 hours a week, in order to provide for the two of them, as the girlfriend is striving to be an influencer and doesn't have a job. She spends most of her time taking pictures to post on Instagram and DMing brands trying to get sponsorships. So far, no income has come from this. Last week, the boyfriend had a complete breakdown while the girlfriend wasn't home and tells me he's exhausted from being extremely overworked. He's straight up sobbing, saying that even though he's working back-to-back shifts, he still isn't making enough money to support the both of them and, which I didn't know about until now, her frivolous spending. He even had to ask his parents to help with this month's rent. I felt really bad for the guy. Skip forward to last night, and I'm sitting chatting with the girlfriend, and the topic of money came up. She started to complain that they weren't making enough money for her to do the things she wanted to do. I politely asked her if getting a job and doing the Instagram thing on the side was an option, and she immediately got defensive. She told me that,
"Of course that isn't an option,"
and that she shouldn't have to put her dreams on hold. Confused, I asked her what dreams those are. She said to inspire people. And then I said, which I probably shouldn't have, to do nothing. She got really offended and said there's so much that goes into it that I could never understand. I mean, the girl takes pictures of lattes and her in yoga poses. She doesn't even edit them, just uses the default filters on the app. I didn't want to argue about the logistics of influencing, so I instead brought up my concern for her boyfriend and told her that I think he may be overworking himself. He's not happy, and he needs her help to support them financially. She says,
"Well, I don't understand why we both have to be unhappy. At least one of us is pursuing our aspirations."
To that, I said, "Well, if your aspirations are to do nothing while your partner busts their butt to support you, then your aspirations are pretty pathetic." Later that evening, I get a text from the boyfriend saying that what I said crossed a line, and now because of me, she thinks that he believes she does nothing and her dreams are pathetic. I feel bad, but wow, I couldn't just sit by and bite my tongue. Am I the jerk?
Well, what do you think? Is OP the jerk or not? Please let us know.
Sometimes we're justified to be jerks. This may be one of those special occasions.
Met my biological parents today. So for some backstory, I'm adopted. My biological parents gave me up at birth. My adopted parents adopted me when I was young, but was always open about my adoption and everything. They never kept anything about it away from me and always told me the truth when I had questions about my adoption. I never had too many questions about my adoption though, as I just wanted to believe that my adoptive parents were the people who gave birth to me. I, 16, female, had the opportunity to meet my biological parents the other day. It was my choice whether I wanted to or not, and I decided to meet them. I thought that maybe there was a chance that my biological parents weren't heartless jerks and that maybe they were just falling on hard times and couldn't support a kid and that now they were doing better and wanted to actually form a bond with me. How wrong I was. My biological parents and my adoptive parents talk it out and set up a date and time to meet up, and my adoptive parents relay it all to me to make sure I was okay with everything. For the most part, I was just agreeing with everything because I was nervous not to make a bad first impression. After a little bit of talking and discussing, a time and date had been settled on. Directly 2 weeks from now, at a restaurant called Texas Roadhouse, the fanciest restaurant we have where I live. A week before I have to go meet my biological parents, my adopted mom took me shopping at the mall for some new clothes. I've never been too fond of dresses and stuff, and my adoptive mom knew this, and so instead of taking me to someplace like Kohl's or Claire's, she took me to Hot Topic and Spencer's, where we found a couple fancy things that I liked and that we thought my biological parents would like as well. Some time had passed, and I was getting ready to meet my biological parents. I put on the clothes and hop into my adoptive parents' car so they could take me there. The plan was that my adoptive parents would drop me off and they would hang around the area so that if something happened, they could get to me quickly. We get there, and after a small pep talk from my adoptive parents, we go into the restaurant and meet my biological parents. Right off the bat, as my biological parents looked at me, they mumbled stuff under their breath, which I can hardly assume was about my outfit. My biological parents themselves looked like your typical snooty rich parents, as they were decked out in all type of jewelry, fancy clothes, etc. Already, I was getting a bad vibe from them. We greet, and after like a minute, my adoptive parents leave so that me and my biological parents could eat and get to know each other. So me and my biological parents get escorted to a table and sit down. A couple seconds pass, and my biological mother says something.
So, how are you liking your life so far?
Me. It's good. Good. My biological dad then chirps in.
Tell us about it.
Me. There's not much to tell you about. I live as I presume any normal kid would. Biological mom.
Okay. Do you have a boyfriend?
I freeze at this question. I'm not straight, and although I normally am not afraid to show it, I was this time. My biological parents looked like very judgmental people, and I didn't want to have a bad first impression. After a couple seconds of silence, I give the best answer I could. No. I told them I didn't have a boyfriend, which technically wasn't lying. The rest of the day goes pretty much exactly like this, just with a couple typical Karen things thrown in by my mom. She would constantly snap and call over waiters, treat the staff like crap, etc. All of this was pretty bad, and I wanted to call my adoptive parents and leave, but for whatever reason decided not to. An hour or two of awkward entitlement pass, and just as I was about to finish my food, my biological parents say something I will never forget. Biological mom.
OP, we need your help with something. You have a biological brother who is currently in the hospital. He got into a car crash a couple days before we contacted you. He needs a kidney transplant, and your dad and I have both offered up ours, but we weren't matches. The only person who does have a match is you. We hope you're willing to give up your kidney for your brother.
This broke me. I now knew why they all of a sudden wanted to meet up with me. They didn't want to form a relationship with me or get to know me. They wanted to use me to save their actual son. I did not know I had a brother. At that point, I frankly did not care. I told them no. They abandoned me as a kid, and 16 years later, they want me to save a brother I never knew existed? I told them no and walked out. I walked out of the restaurant and called my adoptive parents, my real parents. I told them to come pick me up, and they said they were at the Target right next door to me and said to wait in the car or come look for them in the store. I opted for the car. I didn't want to be around anyone at that point, so I just walked and searched for my adoptive parents' car. My biological parents probably came after me, but I don't know that for sure, as when I left the restaurant driveway, I didn't look back. After about 20 minutes in the car crying, my adoptive parents come and immediately noticed that I was crying, despite my best efforts to hide it. They asked what was wrong, and I told them everything. They seemed just as upset as I was, but comforted and consoled me at the time. I'm glad I'm adopted, because as far as I'm concerned, my real and only parents are my adopted ones. Huge revenge on an awful boss that fired me during lockdown. 2020 was an awful year for me. Among many other things, I was fired by the place I worked at for over 3 years. It was not a nice, fancy job by any means. I was just a store manager at a small business that was still run like a mom-and-pop shop, despite the owner not living close enough for it to truly be a mom-and-pop run. To compensate for not being able to be in each store every day, the owner insisted on getting updates from every store 3 times per day. As you would expect, while the business grew to about 17 locations across many states, the owner could never remember who said what or what was even said. It became too much for the owner, which created a lot of miscommunication issues within the company. Every manager was having to deal with this, but it was a bit tougher for locations like mine because we were slower. So the owner didn't care about our store as much unless they were upset. They didn't have to be upset with me, But if I was next on the phone, I was absolutely done for. I could outperform our goal, and it still wasn't good enough. Not an exaggeration, as it happened many times. It had been this way forever, but it got especially bad leading up to me getting fired because of new hires messing up at multiple different locations. So, for nothing but poor timing, multiple other managers and I found ourselves on thin ice, even though we did not house any of these new hires. The owner, during lockdown, was constantly bragging about how the business was doing even better actually this year than any other year. But then, a week after their latest brag, they informed me that I would be taking a pay cut to match the other store managers for the week I had just worked, illegal to cut my pay after I've already worked it, and going forward. Naturally, I asked why, as I created their website slash online store and was doing all website work for them, which is what led to my pay raise. When I asked, the owner made excuses, saying that it's not fair that I get paid more than other managers. So I reminded them that I'm doing more work than the other managers. They then made an excuse and say that it's because of lockdown, so they can't afford my wage. I reminded them about the constant emails about how we are outperforming last year and that I am already taking a pay cut because my hours have gone down due to curfews. They got frustrated and said, "Why are you arguing with me? You will get paid the same as other managers." I frustratedly said, "Fine, but I'm not doing the website if I'm not getting paid for it." After this, the owner got really upset and, long story short, fired me. My financial security went out the window and I was panicking to make it through and barely did. Until these past few weeks, I had only $30 to my name outside of money for rent and I was barely scraping by because of groceries and other bills. My direct superior was furious with the owner and defended me, which almost cost them their job as well. Fast forward to when this happened. I get another email reminding me that the domain name that the owner purchased expires today and that if I want to keep it, I have to pay. Now, let me clear something up before I go forward. I transferred everything to them when I was fired. I left trying to hold my dignity and did not make a scene. I sent every piece of info to them over email, recommended they change all passwords after my departure, and tried to send over the domain ownership to their company account. The owner refused to make an account and take ownership for the domain name, and refused to let it be held by the admin account made for the company because multiple people accessed that. Eventually, I gave up. The owner has been paying for this domain with their card, but on my account, forwarding the traffic to their host. Well, their card expired and could not auto-renew their domain name for 2021. Until now, I decided I would never mess with it. But now that it's back to being available for purchase to the public, my friends and I bought it together for a good laugh and a big forget you to the up-and-coming business. Well, after a few drinks and a late night, I made the worst website that is honestly just one massive crap post and then gave it the domain name. So now, the domain name that is on all of their business cards, social media accounts, emails, and business transactions with suppliers leads to a super, but safe for work, unprofessional website that has the crappiest content and worst layout possible. No names were trademarked. It is not for commercial use, even if it was trademarked, and I signed nothing when I made it for them. We all had a great laugh before I crashed that night. The DNS traffic stopped forwarding to their host when I woke up the next day, and now points to my abomination of a website, and they still have yet to notice it. It's still all over their social media. If my guess is correct, they won't find out until the distributor points it out to them. They check our website frequently to make sure of its quality, or else they don't want their products sold on the website and may stop selling to the company. Have you ever had a boss treat you unfairly? If so, what did you do about it? Please let us know.
One time I did. He's no longer around to tell about it.
I'm the bank president, jerk. This was back in the 70s when I was in the military. I was stationed outside Little Rock, Arkansas, and found I was in need of some extra cash, so I got a job at a security company working overnight. Our cast of characters are, we've got me, we've got Suspect 1, Suspect 2, Police Officer 1, and Police Officer 2. There were three of us who worked security at a prominent downtown bank, one for day shift, one for swing shift, and one for night. I was the swing shift guard. On the job, we had time clocks, and we had to punch in on different areas showing we were patrolling. There was one revolver for the three of us, and we found out it wasn't in working order. So it was my third night. I had just taken over from the older daylight guard and started making my rounds with my privately owned weapon and cleaning the duty weapon between patrols. The daylight guard didn't pass any information on and didn't write anything in the log, so I figured nothing out of the ordinary. One of the time clocks was in the main lobby behind the cashier's cage. When I entered the lobby, I noticed the vault was open, a light on, and some muffled speaking from inside. So I called for the police and proceeded to the vault. Me.
Hands up, and they better be empty.
They put their hands up and slowly turned to me. They were in casual attire, had cash and books out, plus a good-sized hand tote next to them. Suspect 1.
What the heck do you think you're doing? Do you know who I am?
Me. It appears you're stealing money and you are a thief. Suspect 1.
You idiot. I'm Mr. Name, the bank president. We're doing an audit.
Me. Got identification to prove that? Now this was before lanyards, and many weren't issued IDs proving their identities or where they work. Suspect 1.
Not on me. My coat is inside my office. I can go get it.
Me.
Nope.
You gentlemen walk out to the lobby, sit down, and keep your hands up until the police show up. You could see the anger in Suspect 1's face, and Suspect 2 was shaking so hard, I could have sworn the building was shaking. A minute later, two cops ran in from where the security office was. They had a key for that door, and Officer 1 asked what was going on. I told him my story, while Officer 2 went to handcuff the suspects. Officer 2.
Dad?
Officer 1.
You recognize 1?
Officer 2.
Yeah, my father. Hey, Barney Fife, you detained the bank president? What the heck did you think you were doing?
Me.
Stopping a bank robbery? I meekly said.
Suspect 2 then pulled out a government ID with a badge indicating he was an auditor. He was still shaking and was so nervous he couldn't speak. The officers helped them up while I was apologizing, and Suspect 1 said they had to do a night audit for apparently there was some cash missing, and they were checking the books along with cash on hand to find out who had taken the cash or just messed up in the books. Feeling stupid, I went back to my patrolling, then wrote the incident in the daily log. The next day, I found a memo for me to come to the company office, 8th floor of the bank building, and speak with the manager of the company. I thought, this is it. I'm getting chewed out and canned. To my surprise, Suspect 1 had commended me for my diligence, my observations, and the way I handled things. The manager gave me a pat on the back for my work. I'm sorry if this was lengthy, but I do like to be thorough in my stories. Enjoy the rest of your day. If you absolutely insist that I have to move the pallet immediately, then move it I will. I'm a retail merchandiser. I assist with refits and new store setups, or sometimes just get sent to be an extra pair of hands where a store has too many people off sick or on holiday. And even during refits, we're sometimes expected to work the delivery for the aisles that we've been rearranging that night, as the store's own staff have, for obvious reasons, been unable to access them all night. On this particular shift, we'd been doing the beers, wines, and spirits section. Now this is the sort of shift where you're practically guaranteed to get some wastage. Bottles smashed, cans split, it's just accepted as the price of moving literally hundreds of them in the course of a single night. All you can do is hope that you're not the one who goes home smelling like a brewery. We'd finished up the actual move and had started working on the 6 pallets of delivery as well, but the store manager was fretting. He was starting to get very antsy about our chances of finishing up and clearing the floor before the store opened for the day, and his main concern was about how we were handling the overstocks. We had absolutely blitzed the first pallet, all hands working it and it alone, in order to empty it so we could stack the overstocks onto it. As soon as the last case of booze was removed from the blue boards, we moved the overstocks onto it and then split up to work the other 5 pallets simultaneously. As we worked, we added more to the first pallet. When we are in luck, we can get the overstocks from 6 pallets of delivery onto a single pallet. By the time the manager came around, dragging a pump truck with him, the stack was about 4 boxes high, about hip height on me. It wasn't the prettiest pallet stack you've ever seen, but it was stable, while it wasn't moving. Someone had gone to fetch a roll of pallet wrap so we could move it safely, but that's the sort of thing that store staff tend to hide and guard jealously, so we knew he'd be gone a while. Manager.
What's this pallet?
Someone. Delivery overs. Manager.
It needs to be off the floor.
Someone else.
Coworker went to go get the shrink.
Manager.
I want it gone now.
Team leader.
It's not safe to move without wrap.
Manager.
You don't need that if it's stacked properly. Move it now.
At that point, he shoved the handle of the pump truck at the closest person, which was me, and he stood back to make sure that we removed the pallet from the shop floor. Now, I'm not the best pump truck operator in the world. I have a lack of proprioception that extends to anywhere that I'm pushing, pulling, carrying, or steering. Normally, I wouldn't go anywhere near a pallet of glass bottles, but everyone else backed away. They knew what would happen if anyone jacked that pallet up and tried to move it, and they wanted no part of it. The manager obviously wanted it moved, though, and it was his store. So I carefully got the forks under the pallet, gently lifted it off the floor, and started moving as smoothly as I could. One step, two steps, three steps. Enter the slalom of bakery tables and fridges between alcohol and warehouse. I surprised myself by getting past the individual rolls table without incident, but when I started to maneuver around the cream cakes fridge, I heard the unmistakable sound of bottles smashing. I looked behind me to confirm it. A corner of the pallet had decided to acquaint itself with the linoleum-covered concrete floor. The drinks were all mixed in a spreading puddle on the floor. Oh, and on the manager who had been following behind, presumably wanting his pump truck back once the pallet was stowed away, who hadn't bothered to try and stabilize the collapsing boxes. My team leader had also been following at a more sensible distance. Team leader: looks like it needed wrapping. Am I the jerk for making my friend upset by revealing how long it took for me to lose weight and how I lost it? I recently lost 40 pounds in the last 4 months. I feel like I'm under the healthy category for the first time in my life. A friend whom I haven't seen in over a year had to come to my city for a work-related thing. She asked me if she could stay with me and my husband. I readily agreed. In the past, every time she visited, she usually meets up with me, but prefers to stay in the hotel as that was more comfortable for her. I asked her if everything was okay. She told me that she's been dieting for the past 1 year and that she wants to stay in a place where she will be able to cook and exercise and not a hotel. I excitedly told her that even I had started dieting and exercising. She finally arrived. She was a little shocked at how much weight I had lost. I welcomed her and we got to talking. She told me that she has only lost 5 pounds and it was surprising that I lost so much. I consoled her that everyone was different and she shouldn't be discouraged. She woke up early the next day to go running and to do some cardio. I, on the other hand, slept in. I generally do intermittent fasting and walk up to 30K steps a day. I do not do any exercises other than that. My friend, however, was way more active and I was really proud of her and in awe. However, at night she was kind of mad at me and asked me whether I was having a cheat day. I told her no. She asked if walking was all I did. I told her yes. She asked me how long I'd been doing this. I told her 4 months. She blew up at me. She started crying and shouting about how unfair it was that she couldn't lose any significant weight after doing so much for a year while I lost everything so easily. I was kind of shocked, but I told her that she wasn't being fair to herself and that her stamina has improved and weight isn't the only indication of her exercise. But then she kept screaming, and I told her not to yell at me at my home. I told her that she can either stop or she can leave. She left in the end. I didn't speak to her for a couple of days, but she posted a picture of herself. It looked like she started binging on lots of fast food and captioned it, "It doesn't matter what I eat, so I am not going to care anymore." I feel terrible that I have inadvertently stopped her / discouraged her, even though I didn't mean to. Am I the jerk here? Is there something I should have done differently? Well, what do you think? Is OP the jerk or is her friend? Please let us know. Lady claims to know the owner. The way she scurried away proved that was a lie. Hey there, not a hotel story, but I worked as a leasing agent for an apartment complex for a few years. The owner was a fantastic guy, but he was always super late to every meeting and never had any keys to the building on him. One day, he needs to come by and pick up some tax stuff, but naturally, he's running really late and my manager couldn't stay to wait for him. So I'm waiting for him after hours with the door unlocked when a car pulls up and two people get out. I'm at the front desk, so immediately I let them know that we're actually closed when the lady cuts me off and demands to see an apartment right now. So that's not how it works here. As I explained to her, I can't ever show an apartment without someone in the office, safely, and we're actually completely out of apartments to lease, which is true, we were always at 100% full because we were at a decent price point in a nice part of town. The lady stares me down and argues about how we definitely do have apartments available and that I will show her one right now. Nope, I don't budge. I can't. We don't have apartments and I can't leave the office anyway. So she tells me, in the most condescending way possible, that the owner is one of her best friends. He has promised her an apartment, and if I don't show her one right now, she'll have my job. And guess who pulls up right at that moment? The owner. I swear I could hear the cosmic laughter. So I look at the owner's brand new best friend, smile as big as I can, and chirp, "Oh, what good luck! That's the owner right there. We can ask him about that apartment he promised you and get it all cleared up. She looks outside, looks back at me, and bolts out of the office. The owner came in and asked about her, so I told him that she was one of his best friends, obviously. He just chuckled and told me that he had never promised an apartment to anyone without telling us first, and that he had never seen that lady before in his life. Not a crazy story, but just so satisfying when you can immediately call someone out on their BS. Let me tell you about the time I almost ruined someone's life. So once upon a time, I worked at a bar that featured live music almost every night, outside of Sunday, which was karaoke night. In walks a lady in her, I assume, early 60s. She sits down at the bar and orders a drink while the band is playing a bit too loud and asks for a vodka Red Bull soda. I repeat over the band, "Vodka Red Bull soda?" She smiles and says yes and asks for the special of the night. I put in the burrito and made her drink. I remember thinking it was a really weird order, but oh well. I give her the drink in a double old-fashioned glass. She gets her food and 20 minutes go by. We were particularly busy because it was one of the more popular local bands. Suddenly, my other bartender comes up to me and asks the most terrible sentence I've ever heard. "Did you put alcohol in the drink for seat W15? "Yeah, vodka soda and Red Bull." She said Red Bull soda. She said she's a recovering alcoholic, so she had to be sure. I felt my stomach drop. Now that was the worst sentence I had ever heard. I immediately ran over to her and was near tears, telling her I was so sorry and hadn't accurately heard her request over the band. This sweet lady with her wiry gray hair, glasses, and puffy blue coat grabbed my hand in both of hers and said so kindly, "I could taste it and asked the Lord to help me out. I was sitting at the bar and the band was playing, so I should have known you'd had a hard time hearing. I said you were right when you told me the order. I'm just so lucky the Lord has had my back for 15 years. Well, I was in tears at this point because I felt just so awful and kept telling her I was so sorry. She shushed me and told me it was all okay and not to worry. Of course, I comped her whole meal because I wasn't about to argue with management. God bless you, lady. I hope you are still doing well. Edit, just to clarify, because I saw one comment mention she was just trying to get a free drink. When I came to her, it looked like it hadn't been touched, and she happily took her correct drink order right away when I took the first one. Teacher hates senior skip day and tries to ruin fun. Group of troublemakers obey her instructions. My dad and I were talking about our respective days in high school, and he shared how he and his buddies got back at their grouchy old math teacher, Mrs. Schaefer. According to Dad, Mrs. Schaefer was the best teacher he had ever had, and he and his buddies gave her endless grief, including using the phone in the classroom to pull a prank on another one of their pals. However, she took things way too seriously. She was stern, strict, and was the kind of person who could never take a joke. Everything had to be done exactly right. Of course, Dad and his buddies, being teenagers, saw her as someone who could use livening up and gained reputation as class clowns. He told me that Mrs. Schaefer probably thought he and his friends were going to be criminal masterminds or something. Every year at this high school, they'd have senior skip day, with every senior looking forward to because, hey, it's a day away from school. Mrs. Schaefer, in her grouchiness, detested senior skip day and decided to ruin everyone's fun during my dad's senior year. To this day, Dad swears that she picked that year because of the shenanigans he and his pals got into. She announced that there would be a test on this day. Not only that, but anyone who skipped the test because of senior skip day would get a zero, which would affect their grade average. Dad, who had a scholarship lined up at his dream school, was mad. If he missed the test, his grade average would be affected, risking his scholarship. However, he had been waiting every day for 4 years for senior skip day. So he and his buddies came up with a plan and give Mrs. Schaefer the most grief she had ever had in her entire life. Senior skip day rolls around. Dad and his buddies went to play golf early in the day as their test was scheduled in the afternoon. Once they finished their game, they hurried to the school, not even bothering to change out of their golfing clothes. However, this became a big problem, one Dad admitted he and his friends didn't think of. For those who don't know anything about golf, golf shoes have little cleats, spikes, on the soles to help grip on rough terrain. However, wearing them and walking on tile floors is a bad idea. One of them was smart and took off his cleats, but the rest of them were stubborn and insisted on trying to get to Mrs. Schaefer's room in their cleats, which was on the second floor and on the other side of the building. They were slipping, sliding around, grabbing the walls, and laughing so hard. everyone poked their heads out of the classrooms and were confused at the sight of these four guys trying to walk to the classroom in their golf cleats. Somehow, they managed to get down the hallway and up the stairs without breaking their necks and made it to Mrs. Schaefer's room. There was now a new problem. While the hallways had tiles, the classrooms themselves had wood floors, which resulted in the cleats getting stuck. They were clomping around, making a racket trying to get to their desks. Everyone else in the classroom looked up and laughed so hard. Everyone, that is, except Mrs. Schaefer. She was beet red and looking like she was going to drop dead of a heart attack at the sight of these four idiots, as my dad put it, clomping into the room, dressed for a round of golf and laughing as if they heard the best joke in the world. Mrs. Schaefer yelled, "What are you doing?" and pointed to the once perfect wooden floor, which now had holes in them. Dad, who had calmed down enough, shrugged his shoulders and said, "We had time between rounds of golf to take the test, so here we are." Mrs. Schaefer, realizing that they did show up to take the test, as she had told them, and that her own ploy to get back at them had backfired, calmly told them to take their seats and gave their test to them, glowering at them the whole time. When they were done, they clomped back out before slipping and sliding around to catch their next tea time. At least Mrs. Schaefer was fair. Dad passed the test and kept his scholarship. To this day, those holes are still in the wooden floors. Have you ever had a teacher who couldn't take a joke? If so, what did you do about it? Please let us know.
They're lucky I wasn't the teacher.
So Karen, what did you think of today's stories?
They were horrible.
Horrible? How dare you? These were some of the best we've ever read.
Oh, shut up, Mr. Reddit. It's ridiculous what people like myself have to go through. Dealing with stupid people like yourself and your subscribers.
Look, Karen, you can say whatever you want about me, but don't you talk about my re-army.
Tch, re-army. Most of your viewers aren't even subscribed to your channel. 70% if I'm correct.
Well, I can't argue with that. That's true. Most of my viewers don't actually subscribe for some reason.
It's because you're stupid, Mr. Reddit.
No, I'm not. Alright guys, let's prove Karen wrong by making sure you're subscribed to the channel and turn on notifications.
Pah, they're not going to listen to you.
And if you'd like me, or Karen,
what?
To record a special message for you, come visit me on Fiverr, link pinned in the comments below.
Never!
And join as a channel member today, and Karen will give you a special shout out in the next video.
Like heck I will!